Mrs. Barber's Ghost, a true horror experience by Kid Voodoo. When I was growing up, my family lived in a house in a small religious community. Everyone in the neighborhood knew each other well. Kids played together. Parents had dinner and wine together nearly every night. Everyone knew everything about each other. No one was left out. No one had secrets. My neighbors directly across the street from my house were an elderly couple, Mr. and Mrs. Barber. They were the kind of lovely old folks who made Christmas cookies for everyone, bought far too many gifts for the neighborhood kids, and were generally very well liked by the whole of the community. Mr. Barber used to be a carpenter before his retirement, and an avid woodsmith and carver in his golden years. I remember distinctly my mother having been gifted several wooden bird chimes handmade by him. Her favorite was a robin with wings that would flap when the wind blew. Mrs. Barber was a seamstress and loved collecting colorful yarn and cord she would weave into baskets. We had several in our house, each one meticulously hand-woven with love and creativity. She would also braid our palm fronds on Palm Sunday into intricate designs, two of which I still have till this day. My mother was very close to the Barbers, having not had a happy childhood and not many family members left in this country, so she often was over at their house, having tea or wine or brandy, sharing stories of the hardships of American life, etc. The Barbers themselves had no children. The reason for this is still unknown. When I was about 9 years old, on a cold and quiet night in January, my mother got a call from Mr. Barber. Mrs. Barber had had a heart attack and was unconscious in their home. I remember my mum yelling at me to stay with my five-year-old brother as she ran across the way to their home in her nightgown, nonetheless. What happened next was what my mother told me. I even called her recently to confirm this story. Mr. Barber was in a frantic state by the time my mother got inside the house, and had to calmly explain to him to call the emergency services. Mrs. Barber had been laid on the kitchen floor, her head supported by a pillow. Her eyes had rolled up and she was convulsing. My mother, who was horrified by the whole situation, knelt down next to her, clasped Mrs. Barber's hands, and began to pray. After a few moments of quiet verses, my mum heard Mrs. Barber groan as she looked up. Mrs. Barber was smiling at her. Minutes later, she passed away. My mum was extremely uncomfortable telling me this, even now, after 20 years. She said the way Mrs. Barber smiled was almost hysterical, like she was begging my mother not to cry or scream. My mum kept her composure that night and waited with a distraught Mr. Barber till the ambulance arrived. 2 weeks later, Mrs. Barber was a week in the grave, and there was talk in the community about moving Mr. Barber into an assisted living home. We never had the chance to plan much of anything. One of the neighbors found Mr. Barber hanging from a noose in his woodshop in the cellar. Things changed after that. The once very close and warm community became cold and uneasy. No one looked at the Barber's empty house, as if they were afraid the building itself would suddenly come to life and attack them. My mother and several members of the community formed a plan for the preservation of the house, since it was such a special place for her and for so many of the neighbors. Some people volunteered to trim the grass and shovel snow. My mother, who was given a key to the property, would stop by and check on the interior to make sure no vermin had moved in or burglary had happened. The neighborhood children were given permission to play in the garden. The Barber's property had some wonderful climbing trees and even a fairy garden in the back. Some of the kids were too scared to even go near the house. I was definitely not one of those kids. In the summer of the next year, I coerced my brother, now 6 years old, to come with me to the Barber's yard and climb the big apple tree along the side of the garden. He reluctantly agreed to come with me and stood at the bottom of the tree whilst I climbed high into the branches. After unsuccessfully tossing some apples down to my brother, which splattered on the cobblestone path below, I grew frustrated and began to slowly descend the tree. About 10 feet from the bottom of the tree, however, I noticed a light was on in the kitchen of the barber's house, the window that was facing me about 8 feet away. The curtains to the kitchen were opened, and the light above the sink was on, casting an eerie yellow glow from the stained glass. I looked and saw it. Then I looked again. I scrubbed my hand over my eyes because I truly couldn't believe what I was seeing. To this day, it sends my blood cold. In the kitchen of the house, looking out of the window beneath the dirty yellow light, was Mrs. Barber. She was looking out the window at me, sitting on the branch of the apple tree only a few meters away. My whole body was frozen in shock and fear because she wasn't the same as I remembered her. Her eyes looked completely empty, not cloudy or blackened, but truly empty. I remember thinking it looked like two holes had been drilled into her head, dark and deep. The terror I felt was amplified tenfold when I looked closer at the expression she wore. It was like my mother had explained years after the fact, a smile stretching out, far and desperate, like a smile you give when you are so painfully aware something is so very wrong. The shock I felt turned to panic as I looked down at my brother below, who had just noticed my fearful fixation. His instincts were far better than mine, because the second he saw the ghost of Mrs. Barber, he shrieked bloody murder and bolted back towards the house. I was too scared to look back up at that point, but too scared to climb down the short distance to the ground from my perch. I closed my eyes and pressed my face into my arm, shakily reciting St. Michael's prayer over and over again. What was only moments felt like hours, and my brother came running back to the barber's yard with my mother in tow. I was so relieved to see her. I started crying, arms reaching out for her to catch me as I finally leapt down from the tree. My brother was still too frightened to explain what was happening, so in between my hiccup sobs, I told my mother, "She's in the window." My mother was a superstitious person, still is, in fact, and she clutched her rosary and looked. I knew right then what me and my brother saw was real, because she gasped and dragged the two of us out of there as fast as she could. 20 years have passed since that day. The barber's house was condemned and demolished after it fell into disrepair. An empty lot is all that remains. I sit here now in the house I grew up in that my mother gave to me and my brother, and I watch as the property bounces from cellar to cellar. I wonder what I should say when someone finally buys the lot and builds there. If I should bring up the barber's, Mrs. Barber's death and her ghost, that one thing that changed the way I look at everything. I wonder if I'll ever have the guts to stand in the yard again, on the stump of the apple tree I climbed, to look at the empty space where the kitchen window used to be. Would she still be there? Would she still be there? Stories from the mind of Guinevere. She awoke suddenly, and the darkness surrounding her confirmed that the dawn had not yet broken. What had woken her? She listened and heard no sound, no activity that could have stirred her from her slumber, just the silent stillness of the night. Cautiously, she opened her eyes, still heavy with sleep. She almost thought that she saw a form standing before her, but that couldn't be, could it? She must still be dreaming, surely. She turned her head towards the shadow and noticed that it did not move. All her instincts warned her to turn over, ignore the apparition, and play dead. But curiosity got the better of her, and turning on her nightlight, she rubbed her eyes in preparation to prove to herself that her imagination had been quite inventive that night. There he stood, as clear as day. She had never seen him before, but the sight of him froze the blood within her. How had he entered her house, which was built like a fortress? How had he entered her room through the locked door? How did he stand before her yet, as threatening as he was? How had no harm yet befallen her? His blackened, unblinking blank eyes stared at her, his expressionless pale face, streaks of blood from an etiology unknown dripping down his long dark hair onto his shoulders. His chest had been carved open and caressed between his lungs. She could still see the cardiac shadow where her heart once lay. Clothes disheveled and torn, he stood, unmoving, eyes never leaving her face. Vacant expression, never wavering. She wanted to say something, to cry out, but her throat was gripped in fear. His torn lips parted in his attempt at speech, but no sound emerged from his blackened buccal cavity. Reattempting speech, he opened his mouth, wider this time, and as he did, she heard the rumble of thunder roll outside the window. "What are you saying?" she finally managed to rasp. He looked at her again, and unblinking, turned to leave. Against her instincts, she rapidly left her bed to follow him, heat instantly plucked from her body as she did. Exiting her room, she saw no sign of him, and rapidly searching the house lit by the thunderstorm that brewed overhead, she chided herself on chasing this apparition. Or was it a hallucination? Reprimanding herself on chasing childish fantasies, she turned to return to bed. But as she did, a large lightning bolt struck right outside her front door, and a weight fell against it. She creaked open the door to find him sprawled on the ground. He had clearly just been struck by lightning. There he lay, clothes disheveled, cardiac shadow where a heart once was, cursed. Streaks of blood coating him, eyes blank and unblinking, and blackened buccal cavity open in his eternal silent scream, her kitchen knife grasped firmly in his hand. Darkness surrounds me. Is it day? Is it night? I'm not sure. All I know is that my eyes are heavy and I cannot open them. My body is heavy and I cannot move. My head is restrained and I cannot turn it. I want to feel fear, but somehow I know. But somehow I cannot. I feel nothing, as if a deep cavern had been mined in my chest. I try to breathe spontaneously, but I cannot. I feel as though I'm suffocating, but at that point my chest is filled with warm air from an external source, filled to the point that I can feel the stretching of my lung tissue. I try to move my hands, and my fingers grasp something soft beneath them. I recognize this tactile stimulus as sheep's wool, which patients usually have underneath them during long periods of incapacitation. Patients? Am I a patient then? As if on cue, another volume of air fills my lungs and my chest rises and falls with the breath. I hear no sound, no incessant beeping of the monitor, which should be overhead. No ambient noise of ward chatter, no crying loved ones at the door. I feel no painful stimuli or invasive lines, no cold flow of fluid creeping up my veins, no compression of the blood pressure band on my arm. I hear a voice say that I'm ready, that I have been prepared. For what? For whom? For when? The blankets are peeled back and my thigh is exposed. I feel a hand pinch the skin of my thigh and the sting makes me want to recoil, yet I cannot. The voice shares its approval and the covers are reapplied. My mind races, trying to make sense of this all, while the external warm air keeps filling my lungs in an effort to keep me alive. I feel my heart bashing against my ribcage, and wonder which drug I'm being administered to keep my muscle function as suppressed as they are. Fluid begins to flow out of my mouth, down my cheek, and over my ear, drenching my hair. I hear someone in the distance apply gloves, then slowly walk towards me. I feel them gently wipe the fluid away. "You're a bleeder, I see," the voice says, a hand stroking my hair. "You'll need to change that, or else you won't survive the process. I promised you that if you ran from me, I would find you. Now you're mine to play with. I'm going to peel every inch of your skin off you, and you'll be awake to feel it. Every glorious moment of it. Try running now. I dare you. She found herself in an empty field. The grass beneath her feet was the consistency and color of straw and crunched underneath her feet, as though an extremely hot sun had burned there for months. She bent down to examine it and saw through a gap in the grass that the sand was dry and almost like beach sand in consistency. Even if it were to rain, she doubted that the grass would benefit, as it seemed that the water would simply filter through the sand. There was not even a breath of wind, yet the air was warm, and the clouds above moved at a terrific speed. The sky was a hue of purple, with the clouds being shades of orange and pink. Strange colors for the sky, she thought to herself. She looked into the distance, but all that she could see was this land, devoid of topography and life. Could this be the same place as before? It certainly looked similar. She reminded herself that this was most probably all a dream, but could feel the pain of the hardened grass on her bare feet and the warmth of the air on her skin. Walking cautiously, she looked down at her feet, crunched on the grass. She could feel the pain of the straw-like grass piercing her skin. She stopped in pain and looked up to see if she could at least see any forms of life. She thought that she could see a figure in the distance and squinted her eyes in an attempt to see across the land. Suddenly, in front of her stood a young girl, dressed in a plain white dress which ended at her knees. She had straight black hair, which reached her shoulders and which seemed to move slightly in a non-existent breeze. She felt inside that the girl had been smiling and giggling previously, but her expression this time was one of pain. Both her knees were bleeding from abrasion wounds, as if she had recently fallen and scraped them both. The two stood patiently and looked at each other, waiting for the other to react. "Are you all right?" she asked. The girl just looked up at her, face devoid of all emotion. "What is your name, sweetheart?" she cooed. The girl stared at her, hatred in her eyes, blood dripping slowly from her knees and shins. She started to walk towards the girl, hoping to be of some assistance to her. She had no idea what she could do for this girl, yet she desperately wanted to try to make her smile again like before. There didn't seem to be any water around, so she couldn't wash her wounds, and she was sure that dabbing them would most probably make them sting, but she felt an overwhelming need to help her. Ignoring the pain of the grass, she walked further towards her until she was an arm's length away from the girl. The girl didn't break eye contact or move. She could see that the girl was barefoot as well, and must have been so for some time as her toes were blackened. The fingers of the girl were dirty, and her knuckles bore bloody abrasions as well as bruises. Her skin was dry and damaged with exposure to the elements, not soft and supple as before, and her lips were dry and cracked. There was dirt trapped in the corners of her eyes, and dark smudges ran down her face, as if tears had dried there long ago and she hadn't washed her face since. "Are you all right? Is there something that I can do to help?" she asked. The girl just looked at her with intensely dark eyes and seemed to be studying her. The girl mouthed words, but she didn't utter a sound. "I can't understand you," she pleaded. "I really want to help you. Please, let me help you. What do you need?" Once again, the words were mouthed slowly, but no sound crept over her lips. She tried to touch the girl, but pain surged down her body as she did, as if she was shocked by putting her fingers in an electrical socket. Grasping her hand, she rubbed the excess pain away and turned to face the girl, puzzled. Sound rasped from the girl's throat, and she stared at her, beckoning her to speak. It sounded as if the girl was being strangled, and fought through it to speak to her.
"Help me,"
the girl said slowly, in a strange voice that also seemed to echo around inside and around her skull. "That's what I intend to do. Just tell me how," she pleaded. The girl rasped again, face void of emotion. Out of sheer desperation, she touched the girl's shoulder and once again received a pain so severe that she cried out.
"Help me,"
the girl rasped again, and tears ran from her eye and dropped from her chin onto the ground. Blood lay where the tear had fallen, and a feeling of dread flowed through her. "I don't know what to do. Tell me what to do," she pleaded, but the girl kept on rasping those same words repeatedly. she started to weep out of sheer frustration. There's nothing that I can do for you. I'm sorry. The girl turned her head slowly and looked at her. Her white dress started glowing brighter, and fear consumed the girl's face. Help me. The words were desperate and clearer this time. I can't help you. I don't know what to do. Tell me what to do, she said, as if in a panic. The girl's eyes started to glow, and blood started to trickle out of her mouth. She started shaking, as if she were having convulsions in an upright position, and a choking sound came out of her, as if she were fighting for air. She could see that the girl was rank with fear and desperation, and she felt every pain and emotion that the girl felt. I'll do anything, she screamed. Just please stop this. I can't take seeing you suffer like this. The girl looked at her and stopped all movement. She let out a shrill scream that threatened to deafen her, and she covered her ears in pain. The landscape burst into fire, a fire that threatened to consume her, but she didn't feel the heat of it. The fire was affecting the girl, though, and she screamed even louder when her dress burst into flames and the fire blistered her skin. Her skin sizzled as she writhed and screamed in agony. The girl's hair combusted, and she could smell the pungent stench of burning flesh. Vomiting where she stood, she could hear the soft tissue inside the girl popping and sizzling, which only made her retch more violently. Silence suddenly covered them like a blanket, and, looking up to see if the nightmare had ended, she froze at the gruesome sight that was in front of her. She gasped as the burning skull of the girl came toward her and stopped millimeters from her face. She could hear the flesh sizzle and feel the heat of the skull on her skin. Run, the skull screamed shrilly. Rumwelith, by Galaxy. Brunafit, a small thatched cottage isolated in the coastal hills of Ceredigion, was the home of an old woman. This evening she sat by the fire knitting, as she was wont to do. The air was thick with the promise of a storm brewing over the Irish Sea. Little dog was curled up in his basket, and a fat cat lounged across the rug in front of the fire. A kettle bubbled gently on the stove. Old woman was just finishing the last row of her knitting when the hens began to fuss outside in their coop. That better not be another fox, she thought, putting her yarn and needles to rest on the side table. Old woman pushed herself up from her chair and made her way to the small window overlooking the garden. Fat cat stretched before leaping up to the windowsill, joining her in the inspection. The last beams of sun filled the sky in a haze of orange before the inky black of night washed over the land. The garden was still, save for the hens bustling and clucking. Old woman and fat cat stared intensely into the fading light outside, when suddenly, fat cat's hackles raised, and old woman felt a shiver down her spine. Something moved in the shadows. Something too big to be a fox. Behind her, the front door rattled, as if buffeted by the wind. Little dog started from his basket with a bark at the noise. But there was no wind, not even a breeze. Just the soupy air of the stewing storm. The kettle began to whistle, causing old woman to jump and bring her mind back to her surroundings. She hurried over to the stove and removed the kettle to cool. She took a breath. She was older and perhaps frailer than she would care to admit, but she was fearless. Old woman slipped out of her slippers and robe and into her Wellington boots and coat. She turned the heavy key in the lock, and little dog eagerly rustled at her feet. The door swung crookedly on its hinges, opening to the night. Little dog ran from the cottage and up to the path to the gate, yipping and yapping. Old woman, collecting a lantern from the porch, followed her brave companion. Fat cat paced the doorway, guarding the house. Cautiously, old woman approached the gate, lantern aloft to light the way. Leaning over and looking down the empty road, her gaze followed the flow of the valley that led to the coast of Cardigan Bay. The clouds grew angry in the distance. Then came a crack of thunder and a flash of lightning illuminating in the sky. Little Dog began to growl at a vacant space not far from the gate when a second flash filled the landscape with cold white light. For a brief moment, a figure became visible in the space, cloaked and dark. Following the deep roll of thunder fell a silence. Little Dog, Fat Cat, and Clucking Hens calmed. Old Woman was sure she caught a wry smile from beneath the figure's hood before fading into the shadows where it stood. By Emily. This is a true story. I was 18 and had just left a party. It was somewhere around 2 a.m. and I was driving home totally alone on a highway in the middle of rural New Hampshire. I hadn't seen another car for maybe 15 minutes. The only lights visible were my headlights and the stars, which are very bright in that part of the state because there's no light pollution and the highways are unlit. I was alert and sober. I had just dropped off some drunk friends at their homes in a nearby town. Suddenly, I see this especially bright star in the sky. I admired it for a second and then focused on the road. Strangely, this star began to move and got much brighter and larger. I thought maybe I was seeing a comet, but it rapidly increased in size and seemed to get much closer to me until it was roughly the size of the full moon. I had the sense that it was at about the same height as the clouds at this point. This thing continued to descend and grow in size until it was level with the horizon and easily twice the radius of the full moon. Whatever this thing was, it was perfectly spherical and stunningly bright white. It became difficult to look at as it got closer, but I couldn't look away from it either. I hadn't been looking at the road for several seconds at this point. I have no idea how I managed to stay on the road. It never occurred to me to slow down or pull over. I was mesmerized by this thing. This massive sphere rested in the middle distance for a moment and then it shot straight up into the sky and disappeared. It travelled at a dizzying speed and didn't make a sound. Here's the spooky bit. I have no memory of what happened for the remainder of the drive, which took approximately 20 minutes. Whatever happened immediately after the sphere disappeared is just blank in my mind. The next thing I can recall is crawling into bed, so exhausted that I couldn't even change my clothes. I have no idea how I got off the highway, safely navigated the winding back roads to my house, or managed to get inside and up to my room. I slept until the next afternoon, nearly 12 hours, and felt hungover the next day, even though I was the driver at this party. The Mare by Sarah Whittaker. I don't kill people. They never take that statement as the threat it is meant to be. What are you staring at? Are your lungs having trouble? I won't let you go, of course, but I'm finding my life to be a bore. I pray you have no problem while I use your chest as a pillow for my rump. Oh, don't mind the tail. I am no incubus. I do deal in dreams, just not the same kind. What am I? Pish. I'm a mare. Do not confuse me with those devils. I am not the bargaining type. Stop struggling, damn you. There. Humph. I'm not in the mood to slay you this eve, childish one. Trust me, better a mare than an incubus. One would think a fabulous night in the sack is worth selling your soul for, but think about it. Afterwards, you never get a chance in the sack with anyone. All right. I'll let up a little, but I must confess my frustrations to someone. Others of my kind are not as willing to listen to my worries, and you are a captive audience. You agree? Well then. My thanks, dear victim. Oh, your chest is a far better pillow for my chin rather than my rump. Anyway, let us get to the point about these modern times, shall we? What happened to mortals and their sense of superstition and wonder? I have been around for centuries, and the truest and deepest fears never come from demons or hellfire anymore. Why do you mortals fear the reality before you and never dream of us anymore? The terror of the night is nothing compared to the beating one gets from their day-to-day lives. Tell me your worst nightmare, childish one. See, they are terrors from your day-to-day lives. You dreamers have become so dull. Is it true you mortals go into houses around All Hallows' Eve to frighten yourselves for the sake of delight? Delight? What terrors have you faced that you are not afraid of me? Oh, pardon me for shifting my weight so quickly. Are you a smoker? I have seen those colorful metal things that allow you to spew smoke like a dragon. Do you want to pet my pointed ears and scratch them, little one? Or perhaps you want to rustle my fur like some canine? Bah, it matters not. How can I compete with these foolish electric grimoires that you carry? You have all the knowledge of the world at your fingertips, and you are more concerned with pictures of hands rather than your mortality. You spend hours sharing images of other furry things, hoping to see flashes of light and pitiful bells. I have crawled through the terrors of the human psyche and met apparitions that stilled men's hearts even in the briefest of moments. Now, all you mortals fear are getting wounded by your loved ones and losing the means of your daily bread. You fear rejection of the masses that you see through a glass box. I loathe it. I loathe it. Pardon me, mortal. Did my fist bruise your shoulder? Never mind. Perhaps I should be amused that you fools get tied up in your own glass boxes. The pain in your heart that rises when you witness the world and its tragedies. The offense of a social butterfly brings more sting than a scorpion's tail. Me? I absorb fear and terror and feast upon it like a Christmas dinner. What nightmares, however, can I bring to someone who does not fear the supernatural? What is that? Wait, you want to lament to me about your nightmares, really? Permit me to get off your chest, friend. I'm here at your side. Do tell me what troubles you from these boxes of light. Oh dear. Your terror and anger, it rises so much. Tell me more about that idiot. They said what? My word, no wonder. What about their friends? Delicious. Not them, but your spirit. I'm gorging on such misery. Oh pish, what tears. Pardon me while I get you a tissue. What flimsy things these are. I remember when people carried around proper handkerchiefs. Please, continue. No, really. How on earth could they say that about you? Ah, such salty tears. May I have a taste? I usually have to lick them off of the corpse. A different taste, but so strong. So intriguing. I never even had to threaten your life to get this much venom from your soul. I don't even have to kill you. What? Thank you? No, thank you. You've discovered a way for me to feed without killing my victim. Tell you what, you tell me where these false friends of yours are, and I can have myself a little banquet. I'll be there to talk about your problems anytime you wish, childish one. It's a deal. A pity that I am usually not the bargaining type. Oh no, zombies. By Ghost Wolf. The windows of the small bar had been completely covered from the inside with newspapers and broken down cardboard boxes. Hand-painted signs had been haphazardly placed in view of passers-by, one offering booze in exchange for bullets. A poor exchange, in my opinion. Mock public service announcement posters, tie-ins from a recent game release, had been filled in by the bar's proprietor. Under the heading, Nearest Emergency Assembly Point, he had written, You're looking at it, and I raised an eyebrow at the grammatical error. The bouncer was dressed as Simon Pegg's character from Shaun of the Dead, complete with a name tag and a miniature cricket bat. He waved to me as I approached, recognizing me as a regular. Today was the Brisbane Zombie Walk, a fundraising event that saw thousands of people turn out in their best zombie and hunter costumes to march, walk, or shamble across the heart of the city. I was wishing that I dressed as a zombie hunter. I had some ideas, but the notice had just been too short. I'd never even heard of the zombie walk before the promotional event a few weeks earlier, and I hadn't been paying much attention to dates. Besides, I was here to meet some friends. It was purely coincidence that their visit happened to coincide with the walk. The door to the bar was uncharacteristically closed. The large glass window set covered with a sign bearing foot-high letters requested help, proclaiming the venue to be a safe house. Inside was cool and darkened, morgue-like, the thin black curtains drawn unnecessarily across the covered windows. There were no lights. The only illumination came from the five massive TV screens mounted on the walls behind protective shields of plexiglass. To my left, a pair of zombies were playing Street Fighter with old-school arcade controls. The other screens offered House of the Dead Overkill and Dead Rising 2. It was Sunday. It was still early, the other games sitting idle. One of the consoles had shut down from the inactivity, the screen black. My friends were gathered under the wall-mounted display cases, crowded with gaming paraphernalia from Mario to Zelda to World of Warcraft, the only place to sit that wasn't directly in front of the screens. The tiny bar had just a few of those small, high tables for people to rest their drinks on. The group had pulled two of them together, and half of the stools were currently bellied up to the pair of tables. After a few hours, the zombies started to trickle in. They came in groups of three or four, covered in pale makeup and fake blood. There was a zombie Spider-Man, a zombie caveman, zombie fairy, zombies wearing Umbrella Corp lab coats, even a zombie Lady Gaga. A shorn-headed zombie hunter arrived in the company of a zombie in a pretty, albeit blood-splattered dress. He was wearing a black PVC apron, complemented with a fake cigar and carrying a blood-splattered toy chainsaw. The bar seemed to fill up in a blink. One moment there was a handful of zombies ordering drinks, the next the line for drinks stretched out from the bar to the door, weaving slightly around the tables and other patrons. A shirtless zombie was clad in only a bloody toga and a pyramid head mask. It was standing room only to get through the narrow space to use the amenities meant squeezing between a pair of stools and gently pushing past several groups of people. We agreed it was time to make a break for it. We were just a tiny sea of people in street clothes, awash a miniature red ocean of zombies. It was getting crowded, noisy. It was approaching six, and we were getting hungry. It was still sunny when we waded through the zombies to the exit only a few feet away and headed out for dinner. Walking back from the Indian restaurant, a car horn honked, making me jump. A pair of zombies were standing in the street, staring blankly into space. The car honked again, inching forward as if to hint at the driver's intentions. Finally, the pair picked a direction and lurched disorientatedly to the curb, mounting it uncertainly and stumbling over the pavement. The car passed on, the driver gesticulating silently inside his vehicle, and we exchanged looks. "There's a difference between getting into character and being an idiot," someone commented, and we all nodded in agreement. We passed a table of zombie brides having a pub meal. A zombie leaning over a balcony railing above called out to us cheerfully, waving as we shouted, "Oh no, zombies!" A pub had hung a banner facing them all that reads, "Zombies welcome." The McDonald's was overflowing with zombies, eager to sate a craving less brain-related. The group began to fracture, people breaking off to head home. I was the only one going to the train station, dashing down the stairs just as the train pulled in. It was a half-hour wait for the next one. I'd have been pissed if I'd missed it. It happened before. There was a zombie passed out in the corner of the carriage, slumped down in their seat. I didn't bother looking too closely, glancing past them before heading in the other direction to find a backwards-facing seat. They'd overdone the fake blood. It was seeping from the exposed skull wound adhered to their scalp, spilling down the back cushion, and I felt bad for whoever was going to have to clean that up later. The zombie didn't stir the whole journey home. One of the staff would wake them up once he reached my stop. They always walked through the carriages at the end of the line. Luckily, this wasn't the last service of the night, so the zombie would be able to ride back out to their stop when the train headed back into the city. It was humid, walking home, more humid than anything I felt before, and I'd been living in the tropics all my life. It had been clear and sunny when I left home, and I hadn't noticed the clouds rolling in the few times I'd been outside, but there was no way of missing the light show that had begun in the sky. The lightning was far away, the grumble not even registering through my headphones, even though the music was turned way down. Entire sections of the sky were lighting up, and the occasional fat drop of rain struck my head or arm. I noticed three bodies collapsed untidily on the opposite footpath, blood pooling underneath them like a shadow that the lightning couldn't chase away. I offered them no more than a skeptical frown, glad they weren't on my side of the road, imagining they would probably grab at me if I had walked past them, snatching at my ankles, trying to give me a fright. I just wanted to get home before the rain broke, the humidity was making me irritable, and I was in no mood to deal with them. I couldn't fathom what they thought they were doing. Halloween was still a week away, and If they were raising awareness for the Brain Foundation or performing some kind of installation art, most of their target audience was safely inside ahead of work or school in the morning, lights on in windows, curtains drawn. The clouds began to split earnestly, desperately trying to release their load. The large and wide space drops that wet the ground like rain, feeling heavy and oppressive. I upped the pace, pushing through the stifling blanket of humidity that had coagulated the air, wrapped around me and sticking to my skin. The sky was miserable, muted black. Even the lightning was washed out to a murky silver grey that did little to lift the shadows. The clouds were almost invisible, untouched by the light from the city that normally tinged them a murky, dirty orange red. The heavens opened, the rain finally let loose. The city's gutters were filling with blood, foaming pink around the common debris and in the storm drains. On the streets, the zombies were stirring. The sky was utterly dark, and all the night's rain would never wash away the terror. Trickster's Fall by Nora Timken, inspired by tales of the Will of the Wisp and a Neil Gaiman story binge. I followed your laughter to cemetery apples, danced after through stones, over acorns, and past dry-throated leaf ghosts, restless and rattling. Crisp evening scent of fruit behind the twisted tree, I almost caught you. Turned and tumbled less than lightly over roots, and off again, around a marble corner where breath catches. Smooth stone wings and lips cold for kissing, but not tonight, despite warm rose and milky light. Romantic candle glow from turnips? Well, I guess any sconce with roots will do at a wine-chilled feast for worms and goblins. I have no delusions of innocent frolic in this game. If woods replaced concrete, your laughter would crack with the snap of my bones in the sharp morning frost. But tonight, enough to dizzy and confuse. Out of breath, I share an apple with Abigail Never Wept, row 15, plot 3, and ask you, will my cold soil warm beneath your next merry chase? The Origins and Behaviors of Scorpions by Catherine C. When man fell in the Garden of Eden, evil entered the world. This evil takes on many forms, war, disease, and murder, to name a few. But there is one form that evil took on that few people realize. As Adam and Eve left Eden, a new animal emerged from the pits of the abyss. Its long body was covered in scaly armor. It had six legs with massive pincers on its forelegs. But the most foul part of this creature was its tail. Raised for battle, the creature's tail featured a sharp needle. This weapon was used by the creature to inject the body of its victims with both poison and fear. Man named the creature Scorpion. And their fear of the scorpion was only rivaled by the fear of the snake. As the world grew older, the scorpions grew in numbers and mutations. Some were small, and their main purpose was to instill fear in victims. Others grew in size and power, having the ability to kill its victims with a single sting. The range of sizes and types of the scorpions varied greatly. The different types of scorpions formed colonies and spread out to different parts of the world to perpetuate their mission. Spread fear in the heart of man. One such colony of scorpions made their dwelling in a small town of no consequence in the state of Oklahoma. These scorpions were of a medium size and power. Their poison didn't kill, but left a lasting impression of fear upon its victims. A large house on a hill stood near their home. And one of the colony's most notable successes was driving the couple who lived there out of the house. But a new family had moved in, a large one. This development was unforeseen by the commander of the legions, and councils were held to determine how to best deal with the situation. In the end, a scout was sent inside the house to give the family a warning. The scout wasn't to inflict any major damage, just warn the family of the scorpion's presence. The scout didn't make it very far into the house when the family dog spotted it. The dog had never seen anything like the scorpion scout before and lowered its long snout to get a good sniff of this intruder. The scout realized its chance had come. With lightning speed, it raised its tail and sunk its spike into the dog's nose. The dog cried out, and the family came rushing in to see what was wrong. When they saw the scorpion scout, they took quick action. The scout was quickly killed with a shoe, and its remains promptly flushed down the toilet. The scorpion council waited long into the night to hear word from the scout. When no news came, they knew what had happened. It had happened all too often before that a scout was killed while on a mission. This enraged the commander, and the rest of the night was spent planning to send in more heavy artillery against the family of man. The next evening, a lieutenant was sent in. Upon entering, the lieutenant found the house to be very quiet and serene. The piece seemed to mock this agent of fear, and he angrily set out to see what members of the family he could find. Climbing up the stairs, he saw a light on in one of the bedrooms. Sneaking in, the lieutenant found two young men. They were brothers and looked to be in their early 20s. One was sitting on a bed, and the other was lying on the floor reading a book. The lieutenant made his way towards this man. Seeing a gap in the man's shirt, the lieutenant crawled in. Raising his tail, the lieutenant quickly stabbed the young man twice in the chest. The man called out in pain, scrambled up off the floor, and shook the lieutenant out of his shirt. Very startled, the man kept his wits about him and quickly killed the lieutenant with his book. His remains were also dishonorably flushed down the toilet. The loss of his lieutenant deeply angered the commander. He had to exact revenge on this family who was so intent on shaming him with their bravery. Deep fear had to be instilled, and he came up with a plan how he himself would do it the very next night. At about 2 o'clock in the morning, the commander snuck quietly into the house. All was dark. No dogs or people were in sight. He crept quickly into one of the bedrooms and invaded one of the safest and sacred places known to man, the bed. He checked the victim. She was sound asleep. Her breathing was deep and slow. Complete peace defined her features. He smiled at himself at the thought of the peace being broken forever. His venom was of a type that caused the victim to experience phantom stings hours after he had stung them, making the victim always worry that he had returned. Raising his tail, he stung the victim's ankle. She squirmed, rubbed at her ankle, and peered under the sheets. The scream that came from her was worth everything. Emboldened by his success, the commander stayed in the bed, tail raised in pride, even after the young woman alerted the rest of the house to his evil deed. But pride comes before a fall, and the commander received a more dishonorable fate than his inferiors. The young man, who had been stung twice in the chest, brought out the one thing the scorpions most feared: the vacuum cleaner. The commander tried to escape, but was no match for the mechanical power of the vacuum and was soon sucked into oblivion. But the commander's worked its purpose. The young woman looked down at her ankle in fear each time the phantom sting came on, worried that her aggressor would return from the bowels of the vacuum. So far, he hasn't. Yet. By Jesse K. I brush past her in the darkened hallway, my tail curling around her ankles as I meow a greeting. I descend daintily before her on the dusty and dilapidated stair. The boards are loose and should creak by rights, but not a sound do our feet make, neither hers nor mine. Nor does she trip over me if I suddenly slow my pace. She meanders aimlessly through the kitchen. A low moan escapes her lips, a howl of hunger nothing can fill. I glance at my bowl, long occupied by nothing but dust. Once she would fill it, and I'd feast. Now my food is scrabbling rats and skittering mice. We pass on the parlour, our noiseless feet passing over the floorboards. Once her warm fingers would caress my soft fur. Once we would sit together on the sofa in the front of the window. Every so often she'd look up from a book, or her needle point and smile at the trees waving in the wind, or at me sleeping in a patterned sunbeam. Now she paces before the panes, unseeing but sometimes seen by those who wander at midnight and happen to peer curiously up at this old house by the light of the moon. If they look twice, she'll be gone from view. I sleep by day just as she does. When night falls, she awakens to prowl just as I do. When I go, will I remain here, her eternal companion? I hope so. Until then, the years will pass, and we'll tread these well-worn boards, silent as the grave. Judy Marie ASMR. It was the 3rd of June. Beautiful day, not a cloud in sight. I had just picked up the keys to my new home. I was excited to start moving my belongings in. I opened the door, and when I closed it behind me, a sigh of relief escaped my mouth. It had been a long journey buying my first home. It was finally mine. The interior was old-fashioned, but wasn't too worn. I put the kettle on, and there was a knock at the door. A small lady in a red coat stood smiling at me. She was holding 2 tea bags and a small bottle of milk in one hand and sugar in the other. Made me smile. It was nice to feel welcome. We chatted for a while about family and gossip around the street. She gave me the ins and outs of what to expect from each neighbor. 2 hours had passed and she grabbed her coat sleeve. I saw her out just before she left. She whispered, "The lady that used to live here was a right one. She used to appear out of nowhere. Then other days you would be talking to her 1 minute, the next she would be gone." We always joked about her being in our imagination. I let a little awkward laugh out, not knowing what to say, but not thinking too much of it either. As she was walking off, she shouted, "If you need anything, I'm just next door." I smiled politely and waved. I shut the door and walked back into the living room. Later on in the evening, around 7 p.m, after I had unpacked a few boxes, I decided to watch TV. Just as I was dozing off, I heard footsteps upstairs. Although startled at first, I thought it must be the neighbors that I could hear through the walls. The steps became louder and closer, as if the footsteps were heading slowly down the creaky stairs. I turned the TV down so I could listen properly, all my senses alert. I shouted, "Hello?" nervously. Nothing. I was froze. I was debating taking a look, but couldn't bring myself to. I waited a minute, but heard nothing more of footsteps. I must have fallen asleep on the sofa. I woke up to the sound of a boiling kettle. I sat up quickly. My skin had stuck to the leather sofa, and it stung as I shot up in fear. I moved my eyes side to side, still in one position, listening carefully. I told myself, "It's been a long day. It's a new home. I'm just overwhelmed." This time I got up and walked towards the kitchen. The wooden flooring was freezing on my feet. Hesitantly, pushing down at the kitchen door handle, my hands shaking and my heart pounding as I opened the door slowly. I poked my head around the corner. The kitchen was empty, as I should have expected, but the relief waved through my body. The water in the kettle was cold, and my silliness had been confirmed. In the corner of my eye, I spotted a fridge magnet on the fridge. I had not spotted it before. It read, "I am here, even though I am not." It looked old, a discolored white. I stopped and stared at it, thinking I didn't see that earlier. That's something I would have noticed. I don't remember there being any fridge magnets on the fridge. The fridge had been left here, like many things, which was a great help for me and saved the person selling the house getting a skip. It was 2 a.m. and I was tired. My new bed wasn't arriving until the 18th, so I slept on the leather sofa that was left there with some blankets I'd unpacked. I put one underneath me to prevent my skin sticking to the leather again. Although tired, I couldn't settle. I kept thinking about that magnet, the kettle noises, the footsteps, and the last thing the neighbor said kept playing on in my mind. I went back into the kitchen to take another look at the magnet and it was gone. I looked around to see if it had fallen on the floor. Nothing. I said to myself, "Girl, you are losing your mind. Get a grip. You're in a lovely new home. Enjoy it." I turned around to head back into the living room. I jumped. Sat at the table was my neighbor, the lady I met earlier. When my eyes opened from blinking, she was no longer there. I shook my head. I poured myself some water, took 2 paracetamol and strolled back to the sofa to sleep. I was woken up by the sun shining through the gap in the ill-fitted curtains. I thought the first thing I'd do today I thought the first thing I do today is ask the neighbor what was in those tea bags. I smiled to myself. I got dressed and at around 10 a.m. I had a walk to the corner shop for some bread. On the way back, I thought I'd call round to the next door neighbor. I knocked on the door, but there was no answer. It looked empty. Before I could question it, a gentleman from over the road shouted, "Can I help you, love?" I answered politely, "No, that's okay. I was just popping around to see the neighbor." He laughed and said, "You won't find any neighbors there, my dear. That house has been empty for 5 years." By Amanda. There once lived a woman and her father on a poor farm in a small village. The man loved his daughter, and soon she grew into a beautiful young woman. Because of her beauty, she was much sought after and brought flowers from suitors throughout the village. One man in particular caught her fancy and began to woo her with promises of love and wealth the rest of her days. He was handsome, with sturdy features and a well-weathered face. The woman was smitten, and the father gave the man his blessing to ask his daughter to marry him. On the same day, the girl was walking in the forest gathering berries to make a summer pie. As she knelt to pick a raspberry, she noticed a man in a dark hooded cloak standing beyond the tree line. The girl called to the man, wondering if he might be lost or in need of assistance, but the hooded figure did not respond. The girl brushed the dirt off her skirt and walked over to the tree line. As she approached, the man continued to stare at her uncomfortably. She ignored his steady gaze and, being a confident young lady, asked the man if there was something he needed. To her surprise, the man spoke. "I have heard of your beauty and ask that you accept me as your husband. I will give you comfort for all of your days and you will never need work the fields again. Take my hand and let me give you the peace and rest you deserve." The woman was shaken, but unafraid, and politely declined the stranger's offer. "I am promised to another, whom I love dearly. I am sure you will find a suitable match one day. Good day, stranger." She turned to walk away, but as she did, the man called out to her, "My girl, I am a jealous man, and I will have you." The girl ignored the man's comments and rushed back to her home. Upon her arrival, she was greeted with the sight of her father, lying pale on the ground. He reached for his daughter's hand and whispered, "My sweet daughter, my heart is fading. Know that I love you and wish you nothing but the best. I love you." The man gasped his final breath as the young girl lay sobbing on the floor. When she glanced up to wipe her tears, the stranger from the forest was in the window. "Please, my sweet, come with me. Let me lead you to peace and comfort." She stood and shouted at the stranger, "Leave me, stranger. Can you not see I am grieving the death of my father? I love this man with all my heart and soul. Leave me." The stranger took a step back from the window and muttered again, "My girl, I am a jealous man, and I will have you. Let us be together, and I can promise you all that you ever loved and will love." The woman ran through the door, tears dripping from her cheeks. She pounded on the house of her love and begged he come help her tend the farm and bury the body. The young man held his beloved in his arms and comforted the poor girl. "Come, let us give the man a proper burial. I shall build him a casket at once." He grabbed his axe and walked to the edge of the forest. Finding the perfect tree, he began to chop at its base when a strong wind blew in. The weakened tree began to sway precariously when it suddenly came crashing down upon the young man before he could run. The girl, hearing the crash, ran to the forest edge and found her lover under the fallen tree, his broken body unmoving. She reached for his hand and wept harder than for her father. Through her sobs, she saw the stranger from before gliding toward her in his long black coat. She angrily gritted her teeth and shouted at the man, "Leave me be, stranger. Can you not see I am grieving the death of my beloved? How can you come ask for my hand when both my father and beloved have been taken from me? I have no one left but God himself, and yet you continue to follow me. Leave me." The stranger repeated his familiar phrase to the woman, "My girl, I am a jealous man and I will have you. Please, my sweet, let me lead you to peace and comfort." The woman again ran from the stranger. Later that night, the woman sat awake, her eyes heavy from weeping. With no one left in the world, she lifted her voice to the heavens to ease her pain. "Please, my lord, take my pain away. I wish to be comforted and for my world to be at peace." She waited in silence, but no answer came. The woman threw up her hands in anger, knocking over a single lit candle, whose flames quickly found the bottom of her skirt. She frantically danced, trying to quell the flames, which climbed even higher up her body. As the woman screamed for help, the stranger again appeared, this time in her doorway. He extended a hand to the woman, who desperately reached out. "Will you have me now?" the man shouted over the woman's screams. Left without a choice, the woman wailed her acceptance. Immediately, the flames were deadened, and the woman's screams became quiet gasps. The stranger held tight to her hand and led her through the door into the black night. As the woman turned to look once more upon her home, she saw her own mangled and burned body smouldering on the floor. "Come, let me lead you to peace and comfort," the stranger said, guiding the woman even further into the dark of the night. 11 Days by Janine Peters. His hangover threatened to bring up last night's bottle of scotch all over the cafe's sticky laminate table and fake green leather at booth seats. He had been coming here since he was a kid, enjoying the old Greek brother and sisters trio that patted his arm or face and sang in the kitchen while cooking his eggs or argued constantly, laughingly back and forth, slinging sarcasm and eye rolls in time with the white plates hitting the kitchens and metal bench. The best thing about this place was the sweet milk coffee boiled to hell and poured into a battered tin pot. He never felt stupid here for wearing his sunglasses, lolling his head with his eyes shut, hidden and unseen, stroking the battered pack of cigarettes next to his cup, trying to hold off as long as he could, knowing it would probably make his head pound worse than it was. The small cowbells tied to the cafe door clamoured as the brother and sisters called out, "Morning." "Morning." He looked up, checking he opened his eyes a slit to see PJ slipping into the booth opposite him, looking as corporate as one can in designer jeans and crisp pullover. PJ grimaced at the sour smell of old vomit and booze, smacking down a folder onto the table. "I only have one brother. It would be nice to think you might make it to Christmas." The smell of PJ's aftershave wafted, dominating the tiny space with combinations of sweetness that reminded him of curling into his Rachel's neck. "You've been back for a year. What have you been doing with yourself apart from the obvious?" His voice seemed to come from deep inside him, cracked and unused. "Hunting." He took a deep swig of coffee. "Wild pigs, wild dogs, anything feral that shouldn't be there. The money's good. So, all those years of training and expertise." PJ trailed off, looking him over. He raised his sunglasses and winced at the white light. "The army taught me to blow shit up, or how to stop it blowing up. If you hadn't noticed, there isn't much need to assassinate people or defuse bombs at the moment, unless you know something I don't." Seeing him playing with the cigarettes from across the room, the little cafe man hurried over with a battered ashtray that matched the coffee pot. PJ pointed at the pot and himself, getting nods and smiles from the owner. "Actually, there is something I need you to do," his brother sat forward, looking him in the eye. "There isn't time to do this gently or slowly, and you're just going to have to trust me on face value that what I'm telling you is true. The fact that I sent a bunch of soldiers out into the wild to find you, risking their lives getting shot by you, should have clued you in." Zippo fitted in his hand as if it belonged there, and the click, raw taste swam inside his head with that smell he loved. PJ rolled his eyes. "Andrew." Something about that military tone made him sit up in his seat and raise his head. "Brother, there are a million people you could have called on. Why me?" The file on the table was a violet color. PJ opened it, smoothing the typed paper inside in slow, deliberate movements. "Your last tour. Your platoon pretty much was taken out. You ended up in Germany for 4 months recovering. 5 of your group were in a coma up until 4 days ago." He sat motionless, letting the news absorb, feeling the slam and thudding of his heart trying to burst out of his chest. "How? I thought they were all... no hope." PJ drew out photos. Military hospital room, ventilators, and those faces he knew so well. A photo of a group of people in lab coats, doctors shaking hands with men in formal army uniforms. A photo with PJ standing over the inert body of what had been Private Jones. PJ's silence kept him still, laying down the photos one by one. Even though they're in a coma, they still come under the jurisdiction of the army. A new medical procedure has been developed over the past 10 years. they discover there is a deep, deep part of the brain that if it is stimulated, it throws the body back into some primeval state where you can take the person off a respirator and their organs will function for about 11 days. After that, they die. Andrew felt every part of his lack of sleep and hangover. So, not having to use a respirator, I get it saves money, but why would they want to keep a body alive? Is it to get them out of the coma? No, it's to harvest organs. Our current method is not efficient. You have to harvest them all at once. This way the body stays fresh, the body stays essentially alive, as long as the blood pumps around, and we can do that. Big Pharma offered the government a huge amount of money, and it was either us or someone else. The government had to find bodies to try this out on, and it will save lives. Every bit of training strained against the urge to show what he thought or how he felt. He knew it was better to play along. So, what has any of this got to do with me? We administered deep brain stimulation 4 days ago on 5 members of your old platoon. On day 2, they woke up, and no, that wasn't supposed to happen. PJ reached for his brother's cigarettes. Andrew pushed in the lighter. What do you mean they woke up? Are they okay? They're out of their comas. PJ smoked in neat tiny drags like sips, his head down. They woke up. They tore the room apart. They fought with each other, biting, tearing skin, and growling. To all outward appearances, they are behaving like pack animals that understand hierarchy. Sergeant Williams seems to have taken leadership of the group, or what was left of it. He pulled out his mobile phone, clicked on a video, and handed it to Andrew. This is the CCTV footage from Route 1. The movements in the film were familiar, and yet he watched once, twice, and again. It's a pack. Williams is the alpha. They're acting like dogs, wolves. PJ closed the phone. You're the only person that fought with them all. You trained with them all. You know them. You're also a highly decorated war veteran, and you know how to hunt animals. What happened after this? They smashed their way out of the complex, killed about 4 personnel, and headed back to the trees and water. I sent a chopper to track them, and we had them till yesterday, but they're gone. In the creek or in a cave somewhere. We have a rough idea. PJ paused, his color heightening. There is something else I didn't tell you and you didn't see on the CCT. That medic you were friends with, that was injured with you all, she was part of the experiment too. Rachel. Just saying her name felt like a punch in the head. She is with them, with Williams, the Alpha. He smashed down the door of her room and killed the 2 other men in the room that had also reanimated. How many days left till she dies? 6, but they will all be killed on sight. Andrew inwardly smiled. A Bear by Bridget Birdie McGuinness. Bear, his father shouts from the living room down the hall. Everyone calls him Bear. No one knows why. Bear does not know why his father calls him after sending him to bed. Bear had almost been asleep. His father slams a can down on the end of the table. Bear, get that goddamn dog to shut up. His mother's ghost is in those end tables that bracket the couch his father sprawls across. They are crusted over with lighter rings from too many cans and bottles. A pattern she never saw and never would have picked. Silent too long, sick too fast. Gone before any of them were ready. His mother's ghost cuts him under the arms where he shrugs into the final hoodie she ever bought him. He pads down the hall and past his sister's locked door. The light is harsh when he exits the hall to cross the living room to get out back. Take the BB gun, his father rasps, lighting a cigarette. He always wants Bear to take the BB gun. It's probably the possum, Bear grumbles. He doesn't need the BB gun to scare off the possum that shares the cat's bowl. So take the goddamn BB gun and make sure it doesn't come back. I ain't paying an arm and a leg for your sister's fucking cat food to feed the neighborhood possums. His mother's ghost makes the walls weep yellow tears down lavender wallpaper she barely got to see, and he can barely remember the true color of. Bear does not take the BB gun. He does not go out back. He does heft his sister's field hockey stick from next to the front door, just in case. One never knows. Besides, the possum that shares the cat's bowl is no longer afraid of him, and he needs a more insistent method of moving her along. Once she leaves the front porch, their dog out back will stop barking, and Bear's father will let them all sleep. There is nothing on the porch. The cat's flat and shallow bowl already has divots on opposite sides. She and the possum have already been and gone. The dog keeps barking. Bear size. His shoulders test the seams of the final hoodie his mother ever bought him. There must be something else out back. Good thing he brought the stick. Bear rounds the house rather than pass back through, protected only by his older sister's ignored sport and a hoodie he is growing out of too fast. He wonders if his mother's ghost is sighing too. The motion sensor clicks on. Their pit mix turns its thick head to look at Bear from where he's balanced on his elbows. Something else also turns its thick head to look at Bear from where it's balanced on its elbows. Time slows, and Bear is sure he can taste it between one step and the next. His mother's ghost loosens the seams of the final hoodie she ever bought him so he may grip the stick better. "You may not eat my dog," he tells the something, just in case. One never knows. It could have ears to hear him. "I must eat," the something hisses back. "You may not eat my dog," Bear tells it again. "Must I eat you in his stead?" It creeps forward, elbows above its ears, and still its head is level with Bear's chest. It is dark and thick, but also spindly and hinged in the middle, and Bear has never seen its like. "That would make you a bad guest," he says, seizing on laws he can barely remember.
"And what does denying me my meal make you, my host?"
The something's speech is twisted and whistling, like the tongue Bear can't see is too big for its mouth and too flat for the sounds. Bear thinks of rings on tables and weeping wallpaper, and his mother's ghost emerging behind his older sister's locked door, and the way his father doesn't even look at him anymore, and the way his father looks at her now. "If I provide you a meal," he says, and his voice cracks the way it does now, "will you take your leave?"
"How can you know I won't come back and eat you then?"
"It's inhospitable to overstay your welcome. Everyone knows that."
"I am not everyone."
"You're one, aren't you?" The something sits down on its hinge at that. Its knees come up to its shoulders. Bear finds himself wishing it had eyebrows. "Wait here," Bear says, walking backwards to the back door. "Don't eat my dog."
"I will not wait long,"
is all it replies. Bear slams the door shut hard. He thinks he hears where his father's ghost will be when another can slams down on the end table. "Bear, what the hell is wrong with you?" he shouts, not bothering to heft himself up from the couch. "I think that thing's a bear," he says. His father curses and pitches a fit, but "I told you to take the gun and there's no way it can be a fucking bear," but Bear does not care to hear his father's ghost. The light goes out from around the shade. His father rips the door open and slams it shut behind him. Bear pads down the hall to his sister's locked door. He scratches thrice and jiggles the knob, and his mother's ghost is here too. She picked this pattern herself. His sister unlocks the door. "What?" Bear hugs her. She is not his mother, and neither is he. "Oh, you ripped your favorite hoodie," his sister says. He holds on tighter. "You're so fucking weird, my boo-boo bear. I'll fix it." He already has. The noise starts up outside. Bear starts laughing, and he is crying. Later, he will tell the story shaking, disbelieving, unsure if he can trust that it is over. "I told him I thought it was a bear." By Murphy. When you wake up, all you can see is blackness. What you can feel, however, is more complicated than that. Maybe a cracked rib obtained from your captor's carelessness in putting you on the back of the horse you're currently trotting along on, slung stomach first over his back like nothing more than a piece of cargo. A head wound to match, at the very least. Eventually, you can focus enough to separate the ringing in your ears from the thunder in the distance. The thick smell of humidity makes more sense now. Rain is a precious commodity in the south. How lucky for them. It's still hard to tell how long you've been traveling. No more than a few hours, you think, but the traveling song your captor has been humming has only aided in your body going numb. A forced sort of relaxation, with hands tied behind your back, feet dangling loosely. No point in tying those up. You couldn't get away if you tried, as if you'd try at all. Your sins had finally caught up with you, and the bumpy ride paled in comparison to whatever was waiting for you at the end. No rest for the wicked, no empathy for the damned. Just as the first large drop of rain hits your back, the horse comes to an easy stop. The humming ceases, and it's quiet, peaceful even, as you're lifted off the horse and set onto the ground with a thud. Two new sets of hands grab you and wordlessly drag you off towards your fate. The humming begins again. It feels like it's rattling around in your head, a thought that isn't your own, trying to bring you comfort. You don't feel like you deserve such luxuries, even now, even as the dragging ends and you're thrown once again onto something solid. The wood beneath you now is cracked and splintered. The humming gets louder. You're propped up onto your knees, and the hood is finally pulled from your head. Once your eyes refocus, you're face to face with a room full of strangers. They have so much to mourn. There's so much blood on your hands. The cross hanging above the door you were presumably dragged through brings them no peace. Not yet. Not until what must be done is done. The preacher opens his mouth, but does not speak. The humming gets louder. The same two sets of hands grab you again, dragging you backward. You can feel the splinters through your clothes stinging at your flesh, bringing your nerves back to life, but you don't fight it. The pain in your side is jarring now. It spreads through your ribcage and into your chest. The preacher says pain is holy. The preacher does not speak. His lectern is now nothing more than a guillotine, crudely constructed like it was made for you. Of course it was made for you. They've been waiting for you for so long. The blood on your hands wells up in your throat. It was never yours to keep. The humming gets louder. Gently, your neck is placed in the crevice, your hair pushed out of the way as to not be cut in your final moments. A hand appears from your left holding a damp cloth, and someone wipes away the grit and blood from your features. You're not owed such a gesture, but when you meet the gaze of the bodies in the crowd, you feel as though it's for their benefit. They want to see your face better when you go. The storm outside is getting worse. You can tell from the wind shaking the door and the sound of the rain hitting the tin roof. The preacher recites a prayer, but he does not speak. The blade is dropped on your neck. The cross falls off the wall. The humming gets louder. When you wake up, all you can see is stars. Someone around you is humming a tune, and there's a heat on your back. You turn your body over to face the fire, propping yourself up on one arm. There's an ache in your ribs, but it feels distant, phantom. You look around. No one else is by the fire, but the humming continues. You reach a hand to your neck and feel a thin, raised line on your flesh. Scar tissue, of course. What else could it be? Digging deep, you find the strength to bring yourself fully upright, to get a better look around you. The humming continues. You start to hum along with it, and the melody is sweet behind your teeth, warm, familiar, comforting. The humming continues. In the flickering lights of the fire, the shadows twist and turn like souls reaching out to you, desperate hands trying to cling to your limbs. The humming continues. One shadow in particular catches your eye, and branches from the burning fire make horned shapes on its head as it dances around. The humming stops. You take a deep breath and revel in the quiet. For a moment, it's just you and the crackling of the fire and the coyotes screaming in the distance. You open your mouth, but you do not speak. In your head, you hear a voice. Let's try again. You aren't fit for death, not this time. The shadow stands up and reaches out to you. It cups your face in its fiery hands, and you feel safe. Not this time. It helps you to your feet, and you look into the sky, thousands of pieces of old light looking back at you. Oh, how it longs for you to try again. Just once more, it promises. No rest for the wicked. No empathy for the damned. The humming starts again. What did you expect? The woodcutter, by that random gnat. A shrill, blood-curling cry pierced the still night air, startling awake a woodcutter in his cabin. He knew his forest and its animals well, yet the noise sounded unlike anything he'd heard. Deciding to investigate, he threw on his clothes, and with his lantern in one hand, an axe holstered at his belt, set out and started on his way. Tension weighed in the air. The forest's dense canopy rustled with a faint breeze, a chill to the night as he walked. Still, He explored his beloved home, exploring one path at a time for anything amiss. Time passed, and nothing seemed out of the ordinary, but there was still one trail he had yet to take. Gripping his lantern tight, the woodcutter let its light guide him. He was a large man, whose body had been weathered and strengthened through years of hard work, but his heart was gentle, and he took care to keep his steps quiet. As he walked, the path brought him to a familiar clearing. At the center of the clearing sat a girl. She looked young, with fair skin bathed in the moonlight's glow. With her hair long, wide eyes, and a long, ruffled dress, she resembled a doll more than a person. She would have, were it not for the blood. Gore stained the fabric of her dress, splattered along the front. Such a sight alarmed the woodcutter, whose eyes widened with horror as his lantern unveiled the sight before him. Little girl. Eyes resembling melted caramel focused on him. She said nothing. Little girl, he called out to her once again, taking a few steps closer to better see her. You're covered in blood. Are you hurt? Silence filled the air around them. She blinked. I'm fine. Her voice was so soft, he assumed that hearing it had been a trick of his mind. Despite having just spoken to her, her lips were parted just enough to allow an exhale of breath. Yet the woodcutter thought nothing more of it than a trick of his eyes. What happened to you? I heard a sound. Did something attack you? Her still gaze bore through him. There was something. Not anymore. The calm nature of her answer left him reeling where he stood. What about your parents? Surely they couldn't have left you out here alone. Do you have a guardian? No answer. The woodcutter tried again, uneasy. It's unsafe for you to be out here alone. Why don't I bring you back to my cabin? We can get you into some clean clothes. I'll keep you safe until we can get a hold of your guardian. No response. The strong, benevolent man began to feel foolish for his efforts.
I'm hungry.
You're hungry? His broad face brightened with a grin. I'll make you something. Some porridge or toast and eggs if you'd like. Doesn't that sound good? The girl's unflinching gaze stared back at him.
I wouldn't like anything that you have.
Now the woodcutter could feel himself getting frustrated. Anxiety and helplessness for the girl seized his gut, and he no longer knew what to do. What was more was that, throughout this entire conversation, he hadn't seen her lips move to speak. Perhaps his stress proved to be so intense that his mind and sight now betrayed him. Maybe she was better off without his aid. He turned away from her. Why don't I bring you some clean clothes? You don't have to come with me. I'll get them from my cabin and come right back. His throat felt dry and his words felt awkward as they left his lips, as if the sudden thickness in the air forced them out of him. Before she could reply, he took a step away, then another. Maybe he didn't have to return. Maybe he could go back to his cabin and forget that he'd ever encountered such a strange little girl. Maybe
I know what I want to eat.
The woodcutter froze. You do? For all of his hard-earned strength, something deep inside of him couldn't bring him to turn around. Every fiber in his body felt inexplicably tense.
Yes.
He stood there a little while longer, until he bested his nerves and turned to face her. Barely parted lips pulled back in a slow-forming smile. That smile gave way to rows of sharp teeth, teeth that, like her little unassuming form, glistened in the moonlight. Blood pooled from her mouth and dribbled onto her dress and the ground below her. The woodcutter screamed. Then all was quiet. By bowling ennui. You're thrilled when he offers you the job. Ordinarily you'd be nervous about being a live-in housekeeper for an eccentric recluse, but you need the money for school. Plus, he's a well-known author, so you figure it's pretty safe. He gives you a tour and you see no red flags. The house is mostly normal, if overlarge, and has a few eccentric genius touches, but he is, after all, an eccentric genius. He asks you to steer clear of a few rooms, but not in a Bluebeard kind of way, just in a stay away from my expensive stuff kind of way, and you're down with that because no way could you afford to replace the rare objet d'art he has in his study. The house is lovely, with an incredible library, including all his books in paperback, which he says you're welcome to read if you like. The good copies are in his study, and he gives you a tour of that too. His most famous book of short stories, Feminine Portraits in Words,
is on the shelf as both a published collection and as individual leather-bound volumes. You've never read his work, so once you've unpacked, you start on the famous collection, and within a few weeks, you've settled into a cozy routine of cleaning, cooking, exploring, and reading. Your favorite room, aside from the library, is his workroom. Not where he writes, which he does in his study, but where he binds the final copies of each of his short stories. You love the old bookbinding equipment, sturdy and functional. You love the idea of making something completely from scratch, from idea to word to physical form. He's promised he'll show you how to use it one day, and though you know you'll never be able to afford equipment like that, you wonder if you might be able to set up a small bookbinding and repair business once you've gone back to school. He's already given you some lessons in papermaking and book repair, and you seem to have a talent for it. A month later, you've developed a rapport with the author, and you often have tea together in the afternoons. Occasionally, he asks for your opinion on his work in progress. Short, non-fiction stories about different jobs and the people who do them. You've read a few of them, and they're good, filled with loving portraits of women and men, combining details from their personal lives with descriptions of their work. He has a gift for highlighting the humanity in the subjects, and you're thrilled when he asks if he can interview you. As the book progresses, the usually reclusive author starts spending mornings in town, interviewing potential subjects, coming back in the afternoons to write. One morning, while he's out, you find a crumpled bit of paper covered in his notes and doodles, and take it to his study to place it on his desk. As you're leaving, you wonder why you've never been tempted to look around the study, aside from your fear of breaking something valuable. Surely you could have looked around without touching anything, and now that the idea is in your head, you can't stop thinking about it. You step back into the room and survey it from just inside the doorway, then take another step in. It's a beautiful room, and your eyes are drawn to the bookcase, to those bound volumes with gold-lettered spines. You step closer to the bookshelves. Closer still. Your hand reaches out to touch one of the volumes, and now, without knowing quite how it's happened, the book is in your hand. It's heavy and soft, and you find yourself opening it. You find yourself looking at a photo of a nude woman, sleeping or dead, with dashed lines drawn on her body. You find yourself wondering who took the photo. Find yourself wondering what the volume is bound in. Find yourself wondering why you never questioned the title of his work in progress, Eulogies. Find yourself wondering how long it will take you to run out from this room, this house, as a hand clamps down upon your shoulder. Janine, George, 567 days after the third outbreak. My father always said I wouldn't amount to much until I killed a man. Our house was a hard-knuckle, wide-fist education of dodging blows and finding places to hide. My hands now are webbed with white scars, old stitches, gouges, wounds. Knuckles bruised and swollen. I'm good at getting into places that I shouldn't go, places where it's hidden away and left to suffer. Those dark, still, hot places. I get better, quicker, and faster at this job I've ordained for myself, here at the end of the world. I walk to the lake in the mornings, mentally singing old Iggy and the Stooges songs, lugging a backpack of bottled drinks pilfered from already looted houses and shops. I like my drinks cold, and the creek that runs off the lake is cold and clean, above the towns and cities below. A few dogs hunting as a pack sighted me from a distance, but the familial thud of the thick metal star picket, the same height as my 6'4", thuds into old concrete and tar. The dogs are smart enough to smell their kind's blood on my clothes and run, predator that I am. I've sharpened the end of the star picket, a truly evil spike that is sharp and heavy enough to go through pretty much anything alive. Weapons were hard to find at first, but what's it saying? Necessity is the mother of invention. I pulled the blades out of a rotary fan and sharpened them. I found huge, lethal hedge clippers and even a machete in someone's shed. I laughed thinking about all the movies where everyone ran around with guns. What use is a gun if you run out of bullets? I learned early on to hide till people run out of ammo and then just rushed at them to get what I needed. Many of my old man's lessons on fighting have helped so much. Some of his weird old sayings, it's not the dog in the fight, it's the fight in the dog. People would stand around and talk about attacking one another. I just get in fast, hard, and as the old man said, if you take him out, make sure they can't get back up. The lake is silver. I wade into the water till it's up to my neck, weapons and all. Watching all blood start to ribbon off my front and arms. Wriggling and beating my chest with my arms lifts off most of the muck. I remember to scrub my boots. They copied the worst. When I wade out, I go to the hollow of a tree near the water's edge, where I stash a bag with spare overalls and socks. It feels good just to be alive, sitting, listening to the birds and the humming insects, feeling the breeze curl over me. Shoes finally eased off, the sound of my own heartbeat, and I hum a mindless tune I think was once Chopin. Or a chicken soup commercial, one of the two. You learn early on you can't just sit unprotected anywhere. I lace up the wet boots and adjust the clean overalls. There is no space in this new world where you can just be or rest. Munching on a protein bar that is 3 years out of date, I scour my map that is the footprint of my town. Today, it's the houses that sit in neat red brick rows, in perfect grid lines, 20 houses to a street that is closest to the lake. The star picket is comforting weight in my hand. I call it George. George Thorogood. Bad to the bone. Yeah, it's a bad joke. As I walk towards the first gate, two sinuous cats come running and twist themselves around my legs. I like cats. They can look after themselves. I give them a pat and move through the gate. If anyone alive is inside, they usually start moaning right about now. Sure enough, wheezy, thick, mucus rattle sounds come from the other side of the door. It is at times like these I bless my natural immunity and cover my fist with a gardening glove to smash the glass right beside the front door. Reaching in, the deadlock is a quick twist and shoulder thump to get the door open. Like all summer Australian houses, this one is oven hot, thick with flies, and dull buzzing that speaks of maggot-laden blowflies ready to dump their wriggly live larvae. The lounge room has been turned into a sick room, and lying on the floor on a stained mattress next to a maggot-riddled corpse, a thin man claws at his mouth trying to clear the mucus out. I don't need to look at him. He's already dead. I walk towards the man, star picket thumping into the shiny wooden varnished floors. I position myself alongside the man who mistakenly thinks I'm his saviour. I say in a pretend voice, like a preacher I once heard on the radio, thundering, "This is nothing personal. No one can save you. It's quicker this way. There is no God. There is no Jesus. There is no Buddha. There is only me in this moment, standing over you. Ashes to ashes, etc." I start singing Bowie's Ashes to Ashes. The man widened his eyes as I raised the sharpened end of the metal picket and drove it down into his brain, twisting left hard, right hard, down through the other side of the skull and back up. It's amazing how even when they are this sick with half of their head missing, the brain still lets the body live and function. I can hear screaming like a tea kettle. I start singing China Girl loudly and out of key. "Oh baby, you just shut your mouth." The next strike is to the heart. One huge lunge, smash down. I feel metal puncture through and slice its way to the floor below, clean. I stand there for a bit, then call the cats back in. There is a certain satisfaction you get in a job well done. There's also plenty of fresh meat for the cats to eat if they don't mind blood and snot. Wiping the picket on the nearby lounge, I listen carefully for any other breathing. Silence. Time to move on to the next house. My father always said I wouldn't amount to much until I killed a man. Death for Beginners by N. A little voice inside the head repeated constantly, "If you die and leave the world, you will be finally free." A little voice inside the heart responded quietly, "What if you stay and wait a bit? Won't you be just as free?" And voices inside talked and fought and grew once strong, once weak. And it went on for oh so long, but I'm still in between. An old woman with bright eyes was sitting on a train station bench. Her hair, grey and few, was disappearing like in a transition in a movie. Translucent, giving an illusion of existence, but really not there anymore. She was waiting for one train, but greeted each one of them. She was waiting for one person, but none came down to meet her. The carriages moved, each taking away a piece of her consciousness. Every new arrival brought a spark in her mind that only left a burnt mark. Her head was like a box of matches, most of them just being black stumps. Those that were whole knew the inevitable fate. There was a time that she waited with her heart too. its beat stronger with the screeching noise of metal wheels on the rails and then fading with disappointment. But the heart used all its strength. Now it was beating quietly, slowly, and a stronger pump would crush the body. Blood wasn't thick and red anymore. It was a pink, watery liquid, a substitute for life that could only send one message. Not yet. She was there and could stay in this non-living, non-dead state forever as a white shell of a person gone so far. She can't realize her own non-existence. Even nature, with her inexhaustible forces of creation and destruction that rule all events of this world, couldn't help her. One cannot build with the void and cannot destroy what is already gone. So that leaves you, the student of the great art. You are alone. You can still see her, a silhouette on the bench, but not only you yet. Children and quick pacers see her reflection in the train windows. Would you let her go? Would you draw the circle and light the candles? Would you open the gates so she sees the last train? The screech of rails, the sour smell of the tight corridor. Would you wait for her heart to give one strong pump, a final now, and blow the candles out? Or would you spare a drop of your own blood and call her back? Which of the guardian angels do you want to become? By Fernhartz. The instructions are to count back from 100. It never takes that long. A thorn in your arm and then an awful weight pins you by the shoulders. You are caught, helpless as a soaked moth. What happens next doesn't really count as sleep. Later, you are ferried to some other room to emerge from where they sent you. Your head rolls back and forth on its spindle neck. You can't get it to stop. You try to apologize to the shape in white that has surfaced next to you, but your voice has forgotten itself. Across the room is a clock with red symbols you don't understand. A name is being said, but you can't be sure. You belong to it. An owl is nearby. The white shape loops around you, and you are made to sit upright. It seems too soon for this. They cannot know. You are away. You are filled with a jolting light, and crickets twitch in your fingertips. They expect you to collect your things and depart, to become an absence in a needed bed. They cannot know. Your legs are columns of ash. Meanwhile, the owl becomes aware of you. It approaches in dreadful fits and settles close. There is something not right about it. There are no feathers on the wreck of its face, just bones split and woven into a blighted skull. What it has for eyes bubble and fume like tar. You are given water, but your throat doesn't know what to do with it. The white shape says you aren't back yet. It does not notice the owl, who is now filling itself with spoiled air. There is a low, seething chant, and all light takes leave of you. The red symbols across the room contort themselves in a way you cannot bear. They are hateful to you, somehow. This is a thing you should not be seeing, and you would tell someone about it if you could get your body to talk, to say that the owl is no longer an owl. It has shattered itself to set loose a thrumming grey haze, an ever-collapsing and reforming menace concealed within a ruined host. It begins to gather you into the void of it, and then what was gone from you returns and fits again into place. The light resumes with such force it's almost audible. Every viciousness flees. Your hands recognize one another. Your voice climbs back into its chamber. The white shape announces your arrival. There is no need to mention what has happened because a name is being said, and you still belong to it. Soon you are led away out of this building, its troubling rooms. You find all things as you'd left them. You have been restored to the world, and you could weep for the goodness of it, for the light waltzing in an oak, who parts its arms in welcome. Something hidden shifts into sight. A poorly built creature, someone's worst guess at a bird. It dismays the air around it until it is obscured again by veiling leaves. You tell yourself, and you tell yourself, that those weren't bones on its face. The Weary Traveller, a short poem by Tammy V. You've travelled far, your legs grow weary, the sky is grey, the weather dreary. You're searching for what you need dearly, some place to get warm. A winding path leads to a hill. Upon its peak, perched tall and still, a mansion looms which could fulfill your wish to flee the storm. Through the gate you slowly wander. At the door you pause and ponder what the atmosphere may conjure as you step inside. Musty odour fills the air. Rooms are empty, walls are bare, except for cobwebs here and there. No occupants reside. Wind starts howling, lightning flashes, rain is pouring, thunder crashes. While you hide, the tempest smashes, all within its path. Another noise now overpowering, fading storm and has you cowering, roaring, grunting, snarling, growling, promise of its wrath. In the darkness, eyes are gleaming, surely you must think you're dreaming. Terrified, you begin screaming as the beast draws near. Matted fur with claws for hands, neither wolf nor man it stands. Flesh and blood it now demands, you're paralyzed with fear. Teeth like daggers, tearing, ripping, claws like razors, slicing, stripping. Skin and bone, it's clutching, gripping, nothing is immune. When beast is through, its hunger sated, its fur with blood now saturated, throws its head back unabated and howls at the moon. Your choice for shelter proved unwise, for you have met your own demise, shocked and taken by surprise by this beast of lore. Now haunt this mansion, restless spirit, your cries will echo incoherent, warning others not to near it, should they dare explore. The Hunger by Emmanuel. It begins with an ache in the jaw. In the bones, you have heard me whisper. In the walls, I have crept to your bedside. You suppose it is a garden variety haunting. Ghosts, having no flesh, have no hunger either. You tap messages on the wall. Tap, tap, tap. Wait for replies from your ghosts that never come. Instead, you find only a shape of me. And, in time, you know curiously that you are no longer alone in your bed. I have come to visit you in your dreams, starving and hideous with my mouth full of blood. I hunch in your darkness and wait to be touched, and you grow used to my presence, my tap, 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 tap. So you exist quietly as the ache grows noticeable, until you realize the haunting was not in your walls, but inside of you. Here was an itch you could not scratch. Here was a void you could not fill. I make a cold friend under your sheets. My fingernails are long and pointed, and they do so love the feel of warm flesh. I have not yet met a thing whose vital heat I could not cool to match my own, nor a warm thing I could not love. I have come to know your darkness. I have grown comfortable in your hollows. Your tongue is a pleasure, your teeth are divine, and I tell you how I love you with my tap, tap. You begin to suffer from headaches. The tapping is incessant. You seek sleep, but I tap in your dreams. You open the closet. You check beneath the bed. You crane your neck into the attic, seeking bats which are not there. You visit the doctor and beg a respite for something which does not sicken you. I can hear it. You say it. This tapping in my head. My mouth aches, you say. My throat is so thick I cannot swallow. I whisper, there is no cure. You have always suffered from awful dreams, and I have always watched them. You wake in sweat and a tangle of sheets, and in the bathroom mirror you lean to check your teeth. All stand firm in your jaw, and the relief is sweeter than wine. Your ordinary teeth in your ordinary mouth. I hope you do not mind if I reach up from your throat and count them, one by one. Tap, tap, tap. I hope there are enough for us both. You drag your fingernails across your skin and beg for silence, yet still I persist. Tap, 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 tap. I look out from your eyes and see you regard yourself. What a pleasant number of eyes you possess. I wonder if you see me crook my finger in your throat, if you feel me caress the roof of your mouth. You peel back your lips to study your gums, the blood where your bones meet your flesh. Tenderly, your tongue seeks your teeth. Tap, tap, tap. How easily they fall from your jaw. Their noise on the sink is melodious to me inside your ears. Tap, 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 tap. Thank you, I say, as you hold the teeth in your hands. I tell you how I have been so hungry for so long. Tap, tap, tap. You feel my fingers in your bones. Yes, I say, we must have something with which to bite. There must be something with which we can chew. Arrange them in a mandible shape. There are so many mouths to feed. The teeth are so sharp. How tender your mouth is. I wonder if you enjoy the sight of your new face. I have always loved a beautiful smile, and how lovely yours is with jagged rows of teeth. Teeth all the way down your long, beautiful throat. Teeth blooming inside you. How lovely is the blood when it drips from your mouth. I hope you enjoy the taste of me, too. Your tongue is in ribbons, but I know what you think. Your thoughts like a snare. Tap, 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 tap. Blood runs warm down your chin. The teeth want to sink into something, but there are so many of them. The hunger only grows. A raw ache under the ribs, so large it seems spread down to your thighs and up into your throat. Teeth hunger to bite, but there are so many. They emerge from your gums. Tap, 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 tap. You spit the loosened ones into your palm. You arrange them on the sink. Hear how they sound against the porcelain. Tap, 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 tap. We had never known a body could harbor so many teeth. We have never known that flesh would yield so easily. Did you know that your hair will outlive you? That your teeth and your bones are as old as the earth? Your blood tastes so bitter because you were the heart of a star. It drips to the floor. Tap, tap. You are fissioned into something else. All living things hunger for blood to live. As you split before the mirror, I hope you see how beautiful you look. The cracking of your bones is no hateful thing, only a kind of song. Tap, 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 tap. You were always meant for this beauty. I have always fit just so. Your teeth will never stop growing, I promise. There will always be flesh to eat, and you are delicious with the salt of your fear. I have always been waiting in the casement of your bones and your raw, ruined flesh. Here in you, my darling horror, I am talking to you. Tap, 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 tap. You have known me, your hunger, longer than anything else. Even now with your new jaws, you cannot escape me whispering to you. Tap, 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 tap. Binary code for Devin. You sit back and wonder if the books that you read are the livable truth, and this life's just a scene. I sat by the river to think just like you, and it rained all day, I drowned that year too. Do you ever look up and see a pixeline sky? Do you ever feel watched but you can't tell why? Our lives are a moment, a speck on a grid, a portioned adventure someone already lived. So put down your hatchet, curl up in a ball, this world might mean nothing at all. Try not to think about it, there's far too much at stake. Try not to rationalize the subtle urge for the moves you make. Is the lighting off? No wind in the trees, the flat aesthetic, a cold eerie peace? I play along in this box of a life where I have no memory of sweetness or strife. So pick up your weapon in place of your chin. Stay still, apathetic, watch this new world begin. Our home is riddled, riddled with sin. Reality is unbelievably thin. Watch what you've built up. Cave in. The Whistling Wind by Cardia. Tom was a young boy full of curiosity for places he shouldn't ever be. His mother would scold him often about wandering too far from their cabin. Don't go into the deep woods, she'd warn. But why? She would never tell him why. One sleepless night he heard a high-pitched whistling outside his window. It sounded like a summon, a call. It sounded like it was tapping on the window pane. Thomas left the warmth of his bed to light a candle to take with him out into the cold and the dark. He shrugged on his coat and crept from his bedroom to the front door, careful with his steps so this creaking floor wouldn't betray him. Don't go into the deep woods, Thomas. He turned to peer over his shoulder just as he was opening the door. He'd heard his mother's quiet plea, her same old warning, though the room was empty. Of course it was. She's sound asleep in her room, he thought. The whistling's cadence beckoned. With his single candle, Thomas stepped out into the night. Once outside, he could tell the whistling was cradled by the wind bringing it to him. It was a soft, persistent tune. It spoke of adventure for the brave and the curious. Thomas was brave and curious. He followed the wind's whistling in a straight line through the tall pines of the forest he knew so well. The whistling would sometimes change from its soft sound to a fast, hearty rhythm. The wind was cold, but it was gentle and kind, and the moon was so full that it lit the path before him perfectly, Thomas couldn't help but smile from the freedom and rebellion he felt. Before he knew it, Thomas was at the border of this forest to the deep woods. It was darker over the threshold, the trees thicker and closer together. They looked to be woven together with vines and knotted roots. It gave Thomas pause, and he instinctively stepped back in hesitation. He could clearly hear his mother's warning in his head. The whistling broke through his thoughts and calmed his instincts, encouraging him and promising adventure. It was reassuring. Thomas listened to the whistling, trusting it with his plunge across the threshold into something new, something old, something dark. There was no familiarity in the deep woods for Thomas, and the canopy was so solid and complete that moonlight was not welcome. His candle was the only flickering light to be had. He continued following the whistling wind, his pace slowed by the tight trees. The wind became less gentle. It bit at Thomas's face and candle with bitter cold. Desperately, he shielded his candle with a cupped hand and was beginning to think that perhaps he was no longer welcome either. At last, he broke through the wall of darkness and trees, back into the embrace of space and moonlight. The sudden appearance of a field confused Thomas, yet he was relieved to be free of the thicket. Where was he to go from here? Apprehension gripped his chest at the thought of turning back. It was then that Thomas noticed the wind had ceased carrying the whistling. The deep woods were too still and quiet, causing a shiver to crawl down Thomas's spine. He no longer felt brave or curious. A twig snapped behind him, sudden and sharp in the silence, out of place. The whistling knocked into him on a strong gust of wind, the rhythm violent and shrill. His instincts returned when he lunged forward and ran across the abandoned field. He crashed through the threshold on the other side, the sounds of branches breaking, the intense whistling close behind. He didn't dare peek over his shoulder. Run, little boy, run. In the distance, Thomas could see a light piercing through the deep woods, a light that wasn't his. He kept his eyes on it, fearful it would blink out and leave him alone. More sticks cracked and the whistling screamed even louder. He ran faster. When Thomas approached the distant light, he could see it was a lantern hanging from the front porch of a cabin not so different from his own. He launched himself up the steps and pounded his free hand against the door. He was surprised when it swung open from his fist. The cabin was poorly lit, but Thomas didn't care. He slammed the door closed behind him and looked around. The cabin gave Thomas another shiver with its emptiness. Empty was good. He could wait until dawn before making his way home. He couldn't brave the dark, deep woods again. Thomas jumped from the sound of furious banging on the door. It was the whistling wind. Could it get in? He was so afraid. The door groaned under the beating and began to splinter. The cabin was a single room with no cabinet or cupboard for Thomas to hide in. No bed to hide under. There was just a simple trapdoor with the dusty floorboards. He took a deep breath and lifted the trapdoor, lowering his candle into the dark. He couldn't see a thing. The front door groaned again, buckling under the demanding whistling wind. The tune was a howling tempest. Thomas leapt into the dark hall, pulling the trapdoor close as he dropped to the ground. The air was damp and cold. His single candle struggled to penetrate the suffocating darkness. The pounding on the door ceased and the whistling wind died. Thomas inhaled and exhaled with shaky breaths. He waited with his candle flickering weaker against the dark.
Ah, you finally arrived, child.
A raspy voice whispered in his ear. Its long skeletal fingers stretched from the dark and snuffed out the light. Clay Rose by Sivan Young. The distant thunder rolled ominously overhead, shaking young Kolam out of a perfect afternoon of childhood innocence. Their friends squealed and took flight, welcoming the rain with upturned faces and opened arms. To them, this was the time to splash in puddles and make mud pies, to feel the cool warmth of the droplets seep through their hair to their gentle scalps, to giggle at rivulets that tickled their necks before melting into dampened shirt collars. For Kolam, this was a time to run home in a panic, their face reflecting a child's panic for disobeying Maker. They heard a plea that formed in their chest but stopped short in their throat, refusing to emerge and threatening to choke them until they stopped mid-run. Kolam squeezed their eyes shut and clutched the prairie flowers close to their chest as a memory, distant and dusty, echoed in their mind. It was that voice, sharp, exact, disappointed. The voice chastised them for not being careful. for being forgetful, for forcing Maker to rethink their construction again. The memory ended with them being placed in a space of near darkness, and again, the distant light setting over their face as the heavy door closes, and again, sealing them in with their thoughts, their worries, and the sound of gears that match their pitch to Colum's fears. Colum, what have I said about playing in the rain? Startled out of the terror dream, Colum noticed that they were standing at the base of the stairway. Embarrassed, their pale, baleful eyes looked everywhere but the frustrated face of their maker. Slowly, they ascended the stairs, holding out an apology in the form of dark pink cotton roses. The flowers shook, breaking loose beads of water that fell into small, rapidly misshapen hands. Well, what is this then? Maker asked impatiently. A deep breath. Colum opened their mouth, taking a moment to give a child's reasoning to the lapse of adult prudence, then paused as their lips and chin slid from their face, exposing a bone-white stone skeleton. Before curious neighbors could see the doctor's failed creation, they grabbed Colum's wrists and pulled them inside. Soft, wet clay snaked through their fingers, leaving breadcrumbs of blood-shaped splatters through the house to the laboratory. So disconcerting, the doctor hissed, placing them on the table. Colum attempted to hand them their gift. The unspoken plea shone through eyes sinking into their sockets, bits of collapsing sludge threatening to blind them. Maker paused, glancing between the flowers and their creation, studying its shaking arm, barely able to hold still without support from the decaying mud flesh. Maker locked eyes with Colum, sending a fluttering of recognition through the compact frame. Warmth filled them, radiating from their hollow chest to still their shaking hand, slowly the erosion of their body. Drawing strength from the feeling, they lifted the roses once more, eyes shining brightly beneath the thin veil of earth until a voice, sharp, exact, disappointed, stopped any further attempts at communication. I will rebuild it to prevent such folly, Maker said flatly while stripping them of their clothing. Large chunks of skin, muscle, and sinew tumbled onto the stainless steel to writhe one last time before dissolving into a grey mush. Once done, Colum's stone frame stood bare save for the frail bouquet of wildflowers clutched in their hand. The last of the clay dried, giving the bright green stems a ruddy coating. Satisfied, the doctor placed them in a metal box and closed the lid. Hydraulic pistons churned to life, pushing the above pressure plate down upon Colum. As the growing hum vibrated their frame, they instinctively hunched forward, clutching the flowers close to their chest. One ultimate act against the inevitable compression at the back of their skull. Fissures cracked Colum's skeletal frame. Their earthen bones burst into fragments around the delicate perennial, dusting it with fine powder before being pressed and sealed forever in a block of newly formed earth and planting a distant, dusty memory of laughter, freedom, and picking flowers on a warm, wet spring afternoon. A Bountiful Feast by Kate B. The axe breaks the barrier. Anticipation increases. Crows gather in the distance to await the bountiful feast. Children are ushered to depart. Adults follow their lead. The elders have seen it many times before. They too await the bountiful feast. Yet the accused remain bolted to the scaffold, plagued with fear for the coming bell toll, while they await the bountiful feast. As the crows before, anguished cries escape the guilty. In vain they fall on deaf ears. The air is eerily silent after the bountiful feast. Now the deed is done. The crows have had their share, their bellies filled to the brim with another bountiful feast. The people will eventually forget as animals continue to devour the land, but no more will the crows linger as they remember their annual bountiful feast. By Andromeda Cat. Another quiet day winds down, and you can feel it. It starts as just a stillness, the same as a pause when you've walked into a waiting room and are waiting to be noticed by the receptionist. Not obvious, but it's only a matter of time until it has to be acknowledged, this dim shadow. The vague sensation of unease causes a small, involuntary shiver of disgust to slide up your neck. You don't know what it is, and you don't want to know. You try to chase it away with distractions and noise, a receptionist shuffling papers and trying to look busy so they don't have to interact with anyone in the hopes that they'll just quietly wander away. But it's not like that. Distractions only work so far, sometimes succeeding for days, but the presence intensifies with the same mindlessness of a storm, building dark clouds in terrifying stillness. And you are terrified, breathing in and out a cold white smoke of horrible anticipation. There's an energy in this dreadful stillness, a spinning that you can feel and nearly hear in the back of your mind as you try to convince yourself that all is well and nothing is happening. It begins to pull against you in all directions, dragging at you and weighing you down while seeming to try and separate you from your body. Your hands aren't quite under your control anymore, knocking things over even as you seem to move too slowly, detached. Eventually you find yourself sitting on the floor, just waiting. This isn't the first time this has visited you. You wait, trying not to move too much or think too loudly or attract more attention from whatever this is, even while it seems to hold you still on its own. This sensation, this presence, has no face or form. You have no idea what it is or where it comes from or how to get rid of it. You don't know what it wants, and most of you wants to get away from it. The small part of you that isn't afraid wants to look at it, to dive into it, hoping to dispel it for good. It's even excited at what could lie on the other side of this. But you don't know what it is, or what that it will do to you. Even that part of you is afraid, and wouldn't know how to surrender to the mindless shadow behind and inside you even if you wanted to. A numbness moves over and through you, bringing a slight relief from the relentless tugging as you feel yourself falling away. You've been staring at one spot on the floor for so long, you can see it behind your eyes as you blink. A weight, feeling like two hands, wraps around the front and back of your skull. The silence of the room, the pressure of absolute quiet, is an overwhelming roar until the distant sound of the furnace pierces through it to relieve you. The phantom sensation of coldness drifts up your spine as the influence, the presence, waits just in the part of your mind you can't reach or understand, pressing against your back, growing, and there's a pause. It retreats. In such small steps as it took to arrive, it retreats back into its home at the base of your skull, beyond the windows and dark of night. Still numb and detached, you can move your slight shaking hand to check how much time has passed, although the time doesn't really register to you. You can take some deeper breaths as the pulling fades and the spinning wanders away, bringing you back to yourself. The distractions work a little now, and you make yourself laugh a bit to try and hurry the last of the presence away. It's not gone. It could be tomorrow, it could be next week or month, maybe several months if you're lucky, but it will be back. The mindless and tenacious pull bides its time. It has forever. You have no way to stop it, fight it, or understand it, and it will be back. It will be back. Pacific Darkness by Celeste. Silent and dark, that's how their life could be summarized. Inside hollows and tunnels is where a young and pale girl lived with her people. Days passed undetected, marked just by the water drops that fell rhythmically as a metronome from the rocky ceilings. Her little brother caught a fleshy salamander that was crawling too close to his feet. Then he ran back to their mother to share a bite of his prey with her. Darkness inside those boulders embraced them. They felt almost cuddled by it, since even the loudest noises were muffled inside the core of those rocks. Despite the seemingly quiet existence, all of them knew well fear, a visceral terror that was a steady presence in their life. It was that fright that kept pushing them, slowly but constantly, deeper in the galleries. The outer tunnels were inhabited by eerie creatures that emitted awful sounds to communicate with each other. They were nothing more than a multitude of shrieking monsters whose approach was often accompanied by ear-splitting noises. Many of her people had disappeared along with the creature's arrival, so they had been forced to move deeper into the earth. She had no memory of her childhood. Nothing stayed impressed in her mind, except for some gleams that filtered through the cracks of the boulders. They were nothing more than distant memories, as the inner cavities had been their home for a long time, and there, the obscurity was ubiquitous. Those lights, even if so dimmed, were the most beautiful thing she had ever seen, and she desired to admire them again with all of her beings. Her people were sleeping, all crammed as always to remain warm. Her mum was snoring. His little brother was kicking their dad's butt in the slumber. Her poor sister was fussing in the sleep again, probably having another nightmare about the creatures. The young pale girl didn't want to sleep. She was ravenous, so she scoured the nearby for something edible, but all she could find were more salamanders. She was sick of eating salamanders, so she started walking back and forth in frustration. Suddenly, she heard bats swaying across the gallery. She stopped and started slowing her breathing down as all of her hunting skills were needed to detect them in this pitch black. She went along the tunnels until that noise, a light rattling, ceased. A bat was hanging right in the corner above her head. There was only one, not enough to appease her muttering belly, but at least she wasn't risking getting hurt by the others while she was still catching that one. She started climbing, slowly double-checking each new stone she was holding on, when, right above her head, she peeked a gleam. It was small, like a thin but solid ray of light piercing through the stones. Despite it looking whole, she could run her hands through it. She jumped, landing on the damp ground, forgetting being hungry and determined to find from where that thing was breaking in. She kept exploring the cave to find another gallery that led closer to the light. The more she directed to the outer caverns, the more gleams she could find, but along with them, the noises of the creatures she had been taught to fear were growing. Noise was what reigned on the surface, and her ears, that never experienced that amount of sounds, were hypersensitive. All the inputs to her brain were making her feel stunned. She kept following the lights, crawling in pain, as the sounds seemed to drill her skull. Then, she saw a big opening that was pouring inside the caves, something her mind couldn't understand. It was dazzling and hot. She could feel her pale skin heating up quickly and her eyes being poked by the brightness of the light stream. That hellish device was the cause of her people vanishing. She gave her back to that portal, squeezing her eyes, looking for some relief. Suddenly, she heard the creatures growling. There were at least two of them, and they were close to her, so close that fear made her freeze. She didn't want to get killed, burned in that odd glare, or having the brain burst by all the noise on the other side of that mysterious doorway. Maybe the monsters wanted to gut her or smash her tiny head like she did so many times with fish and bats. At worst, they were going to eat her alive, as her brother did with the salamanders. As those thoughts flooded her mind, a crippling terror chained her body, but although she couldn't move, she managed to open the eyes just for a second, just for a moment. On the cave wall, a black shape stood out. It was taller than anything she had ever seen, and the sounds it kept emitting were unknown. She closed her eyes as hard as she could, and she crawled back into the tunnels. As she got deep into the earth, shrouded by that Pacific darkness, her body and mind found relief. Meanwhile, the creatures kept communicating with each other beyond the light. "That monkey girl almost made it out this time. Don't call her monkey, earthling. You didn't like it when monkeys was your species nickname. Fair enough, I'm just getting bored of waiting for them to get out of a fucking cave. You couldn't leave the spaceship out of fear when we first met. Well, I just landed on the new planet and this is just a stupid cave. For them, reaching the surface is like landing on another planet. Life here evolved in the subsoil and you need to give them time to abandon it. If we could only speed up the process a bit, let's go inside and explain to them everything. You're aware why we forbid that. We cannot force consciousness. They have to liberate themselves from that cave. Everyone has to earn his own freedom." The Old Cemetery by Martin. There was once an old cemetery whose shadows made locals wary. The mere sight made me cringe. Then I fell off a bridge. And now the old stones aren't so scary. The Hitchhiker by Taylor. Sweat leaked down her forehead, broom swishing. Horse nudging her left hand. Elton John's Goodbye Yellow Brick Road crackled softly out of the old radio in the corner of the barn. "Sorry, Misty," the girl addressed the horse, voice echoing off the wood-slack walls. "I don't have any more sugar cubes for you." The teen ignored the sharp whinny that was directed back at her. Outside, she heard the engine of her dad's old pickup truck cutting out and footsteps crunching towards the wide open doors. "Moles?" Her dad's voice strained over Elton's. "In here," she called back, dropping the broom and leaving the cleaning for a moment. Two figures stood shadowed in the barn doorway. One was her father, the other. "Hi." The greeting was as cheerful as the next, the voice of an unfamiliar man. Misty let out a high-pitched wail. Molly shushed her, walking towards the pair. "Hi," Molly returned almost breathlessly. "Who are—" "He's a classmate of John's, Moles," her dad answered before she could even finish the question. "He was hitching home, needs to get to his mother in the next town over. When he told me he knew John, I couldn't say no." Her dad clapped the man on the back. "I'm going in to tell your mum I'm back. Give him a grand tour if he wants it." With that, her dad walked up the porch steps and into the house. Molly was left standing in the shadow of the stuffy barn with her guest. "So, you're in school with my brother?" The man just smiled at her. Molly knew what she must have looked like standing there. Sweaty and clad in her dirt-streaked clothes. She cleared her throat uncomfortably. "Class of 1972, then?" He shrugged. "You could say that." "And you came back to visit your mum?" He laughed, and Molly met his gaze, quirking a curious eyebrow in return. "You ask a lot of questions, you know that?" "You really are a curious one, Molly Cooper." He walked away from her and was inside the house in only a few strides. Molly followed. "A lovely place you have here, Mr. and Mrs. C." The stranger's voice strained slightly to be heard over the sound of the afternoon news. From the doorway, Molly could see her grandmother sitting in her favourite chair, watching the TV intently, but she didn't seem to be taking much of it in. Footage of protesters, their signs displaying phrases like, "Bring the troops home now," written in bold letters, was moving by on the screen. "Thanks," Molly's mum called back, apron clad. She'd been setting out sandwiches for lunch when their visitor arrived. Molly, gaze flickering momentarily towards the kitchen, turned back towards her grandmother. She noticed the older woman suddenly watching John's friend closely, television now forgotten. Her dad had seemed to notice this too. "Mum," he called. "This is one of John's friends from college." There was a long period of silence while they waited for a response. Lately, it was a challenge for her to remain coherent for more than a moment. "Why are you here?" Her voice cracked abruptly. Molly was surprised by her directness. "You need to leave. I won't let you touch my family." Her pitch rose into a near wail. "Mum," Molly's dad began to warn, alarm in his voice, but the young man held out a hand. He approached the woman, kneeling down to the level at which she sat. "It's not your time yet," he whispered to her. Molly watched the scene, an anxious feeling twisting in her belly. The young man patted her grandmother's hand and stood. His smile didn't reach his eyes, and Molly looked back to see the expressions on each of her parents' face. Her mother looked startled, and her father, stoic. "I didn't come here to scare all of you," the young man announced. "Then what?" Molly challenged. The stranger looked between the three of them. "John is dead." There was a deafening silence, then the shattering of ceramic on the kitchen floor. Molly thought she'd be sick if she spared a glance in her parents' direction. "I'm sorry," the man offered. "I don't get to usually tell people like you, but I bumped into you on the road and..." "You killed my son?" Molly's dad exploded, confusion written all over his features. The stranger shook his head slowly. "No," he moved towards the door without a second. "I'm just the ferryman." Then he was gone. With everyone else in the house frozen in place, Molly shook herself out of her stupor and ran to the window. A phone rang in the distance behind her, and a moment later she could hear her mother sobbing. Everything seemed to move in slow motion. "He'll be back soon," Molly's grandmother stated with a dark finality. The words were lost to Molly as she watched the stranger walk down the dusty driveway, casting a shadow of hood and scythe over the weeds at the side of the road. Wolves in the Woods by Undeniably Emily. The woods are alive. Everyone who lives anywhere close to it knows that. They don't know what I know, or maybe they do. Maybe they can feel the way it watches, breathes, waits. I know that's how it feels for me. Not really the boy I've brought with me. Oh, he's sweet enough. At least he pretends to be, for my sake. He's big and pretty and maybe a little dumb, but he lets me hold his arm as we bounce and stomp our way down the moonlit path. Respectively, I bounce. He stomps, and honestly, had I not known he was some big athlete, I wouldn't have believed it, as he wasn't very light on his feet. I beam up at him, enjoying the furrow between his brows as he considers what I just said. "There isn't, though. I've hunted in these woods plenty of times with my dad. If there were wolves, we would have seen them." "Not if they didn't want you to see them." My laugh is higher pitched than normal, but he doesn't know the difference. I just met him earlier at a party. Officially met him, anyway. You really can't live in town and not know who he is by reputation alone. His family is well known as the Woods, and maybe it wasn't smart of me to bring him here. Maybe I shouldn't have set my sights so high, but he seems to like my attention enough to come here. That I consider a win. What I don't consider a win, however, is the way his furrow deepens at my laugh. He stopped in his tracks, my arm looped through his, forcing my body to jerk back. I bump into him, not quite sure if it's the night or the drinks I'd had earlier that keep off my balance, as he guides us off the path and pushes me against a tree. "Hey, come on." My mouth quirks into a soft pout as I look at him through my lashes. "We gotta keep going." "We've been walking long enough, Lucy. I figure it's time you show me what's so special that we had to come here to be alone." His face cracks into what can only be described as a predatory smirk. I bite back a sigh. I can't say I didn't see this coming. It's not as though it hasn't come before. My head tilts to the side. "It's something extra special, just for you." I even throw in a wink. "It's not here, though. It's just a little further up the path. I promise it's even better than I can describe." He wants to push things. I can tell that. And if he got out of hand, I could only hope the woods would carry my screams to ears that could help me. That was the gamble. That was a risk I took every time. One day, my luck would run out. But not today. Today, he takes a step back, but not before pressing his mouth hard against mine in a kiss that's too hot and too harsh to be enjoyable. I curve my lips up in a smile, just for him, though, when he pulls back. If there were any doubts as to whether I chose the right guy to bring with me, he put an end to them, and my steps are even lighter as I tug him along the path. When we finally arrive at the clearing, he stops short, yet again jerking my arm slightly. This time I don't mind. The branches part just enough to allow the silvery light to seem almost brighter. I expect shock at just how special my something special is, but he doesn't pull away completely, which is better than the last guy. I can feel his muscles tense under my fingertips, still lightly resting on his arm. "Lucy, what the fuck?" My mouth curls into a soft smile. "What? I told you there were wolves in the woods. They didn't want you to see them before, but now they do. It's more fun for them when you do." "Those aren't wolves, they're..." His words stop, face twisted in disgust. My hands grip harder on his arm as I turn to face them. I can't blame him for not being as happy to see them as I am. It's not as though anything prepares you for seeing them for the first time. I was barely 5 when I did, and they seemed as tall as the trees around us. They're really only slightly taller than him, though, but broader, by far. And the looks in their eyes as their lips curl in a snarl would send chills down anyone's spine. That's if their eyes could pull away from teeth that were at least 2 inches long and dripping red with blood and viscera from what had been unfortunate enough to cross into the clearing before we got here. I'm used to it, though. As many times I've brought boys to their special spot, I have to be. Used to the fur and the rhythmic growls low in their throats as they circle us. Realization flickers across his face, and with a final squeeze, I let go of his arm. His eyes, flashing with fear, manage to meet mine. There's the barest trace of hatred in there for me, and I can't blame him. I don't even blame him when I feel his hot, clammy hands clasp on my arms, pushing me in front of him towards the circling, snarling pack. His face grows pale as they part just enough to let me slip out between two of them, before tightening their inner circle around him. He wears the same look I've seen before. "Lucy! Lucy, what the fu—" "Shh, it's okay." I give him a soft smile. "They're my friends." He disappears from my view behind a wall of muscle and fur. And they're hungry. This next one is by Abu Lafia. It's in Italian, so... okay. Wish me luck. Freely adapted from the real story of Leonardo Cianciulli, Italian serial killer known as the soap maker of Correggio. La notte era il momento migliore, pensava, tutti dormono e non fanno caso al rumore. Sinistro rumore di ossa spiccate, segate e corpi pesanti di devora spostare. Facevano un rumore sordo sul pavimento quando le bestie, super forti, non avevano più le forze necessarie per tenere lì su. Una parte del sangue veniva raccolta in un catino, lasciato coagulare e poi cotto. Insieme a farina, zucchero, cioccolato nero, latte e uova serviva per fare dei pasticcini, crociatini, coccianti, dal sapore feroce di mangiare in compagna. Ma adesso bisognava soltanto pensare a finire il lavoro. Fare a pesi quel cadavere finisce tutto la furia e ricupa come la sua anima. Un lungo buco si poteva diritti all'inferno. Occorrevano molte ore di lavoro pes membrana un corpo mali lavorava solo come un muratore intento a finire il suo lavoro senza soste. Il tempo passava vol ciel, lavorava solo un morante intento a finire il suo lavoro senza soste. Il tempo passava veloce. Il pantalone gia pieno di acqua riboliva sul fuoco. Bastava a griogare le sorelle schia ad assenere. Il tutto pare fare delle graziose saponette da regalare alle amici. Sapone di morte, di foglia, di fantasmi di bambini mai nati ciel galvano, anime candide, mentre demoni con piacchiotti le sussurravano deliri infernali.
The pull of the current. By the red wolf. The raindrops thumped like a bodhran drum on her sparkling red umbrella. With every tentative step, her blue eyes glided around to take in the golden autumn colours at her feet. It was like walking on a majestic carpet rolled out just for her. The tree trunks stood as dark as death and were spotted with lichen. The girl inhaled the pungent, earthy scents as she twirled around in her shiny red rain boots, stretching out a hand to hold onto the rain. The trees shook like dogs, scattering red, brown, and yellow into the air. Then, the rain began to slow. The girl closed her red umbrella and inclined her head to feel the rain's last caresses. The red hood fell back, letting her yellow hair shimmer in the watery grey light. With her hands in the air, she swayed to unheard music, eyes smiling at the treetops. Once more, the wind picked up, and she thought she heard her name blowing through the trees. Saoirse, Saoirse. Saoirse left the path and weaved between this tree and that, laying a gentle hand on them as she passed. A raven sat on a branch and greeted her with a croaking call. Saoirse gave a small hello, wary of the conflicting Celtic beliefs about ravens. She thought it best to, at least, be polite. Saoirse stood on the creaky bridge where the current below was strong and thunderous. With a toss of her hand, Saoirse dropped a maple leaf into the stream. She gazed down into the depths and mused about how the leaf was pulled along, unknowing of its fate. She heard the call again. Saoirse, Saoirse. She abruptly turned to where she had just come. There was no denying it came from the forest. For several days now, she had heard it. But who was calling for her? Saoirse knew she had best be on her way if she was to be on time for school. She didn't want her mother finding out that she was late because then Saoirse would have to admit to being in the forest, a place she was forbidden to go by herself. With one last deep breath, she headed to school. Everyone spoke of the murdered boy. It had been several days since the incident in the forest, but gossip continued to be whispered by the staff and children. It echoed through the playground, it echoed through the halls, and out to the playground like the twittering of birds. Saoirse heard all kinds of stories and didn't know what to believe. All she knew was that she missed Ireland, wishing her stepmother hadn't moved them to America. Most of all, Saoirse knew she couldn't give up her new home, the forest. That night, Saoirse woke in a cold sweat from ghoulish nightmares. Images of howling wolves, banshees, and the Dullahan preyed upon her mind, and she understood why. She could hear the call from the forest echoing in her room. Sitting up in her bed, she heard the wind's moans rattling the panes. Saoirse. Approaching the window, she saw the entrance to the forest far up the road. Still shaking from the nightmares, Saoirse crept out of the house and ventured into the forest, the cries growing louder until she was finally inside her leafy sanctuary again. Searching for some sign, Saoirse made her way to the center of the dark forest and asked in her small 7-year-old voice, "What do you need of me then?" Something grabbed her ankles, causing her to fall back. A pair
of skeletal hands clawed out to the ground, trying to reach her. Another set popped out before her, and another. Soon, there were dozens of them. Saoirse watched in cold fear as the zombies broke out of their dirt prison and staggered towards her. She stumbled to her feet, turning to run, but was caught by one of them, their arms wrapping around her.
"Shh, it's all right. Shh, we're not going to hurt you."
The wind's whispers soothed her. She saw that dark-haired boy held her.
"My name is Ray. What do you want of me?"
Saoirse asked, nervously looking back at the surrounding zombies. And I let her go.
"They need another guardian to stop these murders. Someone who will protect the forest from bad people. They chose me as their guardian, but I need help. Please, will you help us?"
Saoirse looked at the zombies, noticing the different ages and genders. Some leaned towards her, putting their hands together in prayer as they bowed their heads. It saddened her to see her forest was a cemetery of serial killings.
I don't know what I can do. Just love the forest as you always have. I will show you the rest. But my stepmom. You don't have to ever go back, Saoirse."
It was as if Adahi could see her into her soul and see how miserable she was. He raised his arms.
"Is this not home to you?"
Saoirse's eyes watered.
"Tears."
Adahi moved it. Adahi offered his hand, smiling.
"Then come with me. I will make you ageless and give you powers so you can tend to your home with me."
She smiled, taking his hand. He didn't know how much his gesture meant to her. The zombies returned to their unmarked graves and the earth was undisturbed again. Something lightly brushed her cheek and Saoirse saw it was a large oak tree touching her with one of its branches.
"The forest is happy. It thanks you."
Saoirse may have been from the Emerald Isle, but she never imagined experiencing magic firsthand.
"You'll be given an animal form, just as I have," Adahi explained. "I chose a raven. What do you choose?"
Saoirse thought, looking down at her red coat and boots. "A red wolf." Smiling, they left the heart of the forest, disappearing together into the leaves and the wind, where they danced and guarded their beloved forest. His Mother's Eyes, a children's story by Alison Bede. The sunny spot beneath the window still grew colder, and the potted plants were replaced with strange orange melons the child had never seen before. Once a favorite spot to stretch and think, it now held an aura of mystery. Sunlight no longer streamed through the panes with the same intensity as it had in the summer months. Instead, he gazed out and saw the tendrils of misty fog curling about the feet of passers-by. He imagined the hands of the mist scrubbing out the greens of the earth, and in their place, peeking through the gloom, the vibrant reds, mustards, and sienas greeted the young lad. He was a curious child, as all precocious young boys will be. He had never seen such sights, and questions filled his thoughts until they flooded over his mind. Yet the only one he had to ask was his mother. While she never turned away his constant barrage of pestering questions, he hesitated because lately she had grown more silent and weary with the changing of the season. He thought his mother to be stern yet kind, but now that silent melancholy gripped her heart, formed by the memories of her other life before mother and child had been taken into the safety of the house where they now resided. She never spoke of the other life, the one on the streets where the incident had occurred. As reluctant as the boy was to trouble her, when the other children of the house pulled out boxes filled with fluffy feathers, shiny sequins, colourful gloves, and frightening masks, he could no longer contain the brimming curiosity. He found her tucked away in a corner, staring silently about her with that unnamed sorrow that came at the same time as the orange melons. But when she saw her son, both her head and spirits lifted. "Yes, little Dill?" she asked in her warm, dulcet tone. The child pouted a moment at the sound of his mother's silly pet name for him, but he promptly took his finger from the dike, and a sea of questions spilled forth. He hardly paused to take a breath, so that by the end he was practically panting. The mother was silent a moment, and when she spoke, her voice was less warm. "The children are getting ready for Halloween.
What?
They dress up as funny or scary creatures, sometimes even witches or cats. They walk about the neighborhood and return with treats. The The boy pondered for hardly a second before crying out, "Well, I want to go. I want Halloween. I won't even need... No. But I forbid it." The mother turned, pulled herself to full height, and gazed sternly down at the child with her only remaining eye. It was often clouded with the haunting memory the child would never know, could never know. He often cowered before the eye, never wanting to look upon it, for in it he only saw his mother's sternness and command, the pain and the sorrow. He feared her one eye more than anything he had ever encountered in his short life, and this was a shame, really, for had he truly looked, he would have seen the secret sparkle of all her love and known the secret of all she had done for him, all she had sacrificed to protect him. Well, dear friends, I wish I could say our young scoundrel had listened to his mother's order, but how many of you always followed your parents' rules? I didn't think so. Late in the afternoon of All Hallows' Eve, the child slipped out of the door while one of the household servants went to retrieve the mail. He was immediately greeted by the brisk autumn air that seemed to smell faintly of cinnamon. He seldom ventured outside except for under his mother's ever-watchful eye. She would never let him go far, though he longed with every fibre of his being to explore. He didn't understand why she was so fearful, but knew it had something to do with the missing eye, the scarlet scar that stretched across the empty space, and the perpetual limp on her left side. Yet he never asked, for such a thing a boy could never know. Now he left the yard and journeyed farther than he ever dared. The sky grew dusk, and he relished in the crispness of the air and the delicate crunch of leaves beneath his feet. He paused at several homes and curiously explored the decorations adorning them. Some made him laugh, and some made him gasp with fright. Many also had these strange orange melons on their porches, but with faces carved into them that ranged from delightful to ghoulish. So taken was he that the sun had set, and darkness grew around him without his notice. Ere long, though, realized he had wandered much too far and was quite lost. And now he wasn't alone with the leaves and melons, for the streets were filled with strange creatures, and he had forgotten his mother's words that they were simply children. He weaved through the throng, panic pouring at his heart. So utterly lost was he that all stubborn childish pride was forgotten, and he began to cry out for help. But all ignored his desperate pleas and instead darted around him, intent on their quests for treats. All but one, that is. It began to draw near the boy slowly at first, gloved hands outstretched. Then it quickened its pace and approached with purpose and resolve. The boy peered up and balked in horror as the face was hideous to behold. More frightening than his mother's gruesome jagged scars, this face seemed horribly deformed, as though it had half melted in a fiery furnace. A chilling acid green substance oozed from the eyes, and when it spoke, the mouth did not move. Speak it did, and the boy's heart skipped a beat, as the monster seemed to know his name. It reached out the gloved hands and almost snatched the child, but he was too quick and darted away, tears in his eyes nearly blinding him until he came to a screeching halt. Now he was on a new block, not as greatly populated. In the darkness loomed three hulking figures, but that was not what stopped the boy in his tracks. There, smashed against the asphalt, was one of the orange melons, its sticky innards smeared across the black top, the face utterly crushed and unrecognizable, except for one thing. Its one carved eye remained intact, and it stared up at the boy in horror and pain as though it pleaded for reprieve. It held a secret the boy didn't know. The crashing thud of another pumpkin broke him from his horrified trance. The shell came just inches shy of crushing his skull. The looming figures were not so distant now, and the boy could make out the silhouettes of three teenage boys, two of which bore baseball bats, the third holding a burlap sack. Could they be the same ones in an incident from a memory past? I cannot say, but to tell you this, our young friend was indeed in ultimate peril. "What do we have here?" one sneered. "Let's get him," another chuckled sinisterly. Scrambling again, but with much less grace, the boy raced down the avenue, nearly tripping over his own feet. He heard the thundering footsteps behind him and threats being shouted at a distance, such words that I shall not repeat here, my friends. The boy's folly was made complete, however, when he slipped into an alley with a dead end. He was stopped by a fence far too high for him to scale. A shadowy figure entered the alley. Desperately, the boy made a feeble attempt to climb. Now, I'm sure you've heard stories of how in moments of great duress, people are capable of accomplishing impossible feats. Well, sorry to say, this is not one of those stories. Down he crashed, landing on his feet, but greatly dazed. He backed up against the chain link and attempted to make himself look as big as possible. He tried to call out a threat, but only a small hiss escaped his lips. The shadow moved nearer, and the street lamp illuminated the monster with a deformed face. It spoke his name as it grew closer. And then it did a curiously horrifying thing. It ripped away its face. The boy closed his eyes and screamed, but when he opened them, the monster was gone. In its place was the oldest child of his mother's household servants, who was out taking the younger ones for tricks and treats. She smiled at him and said his name again. "What are you doing out here?" she asked. "You ought to be home." She outstretched her arms and held him close. Usually the child would squirm away as he detested such affection, but he melted in her arms and relished in the feeling of safety at last. When they arrived home, the boy's first sight was his mother in the window. Worry and fear etched on her face, her eye pierced through the darkness clouded with concern. He trembled, but when he entered the room, her cry of delight dispelled the boy's fear immediately. He ran to her and curled up beneath her chin as she nuzzled him close. From the distance, the other children of the house dumped their evening haul upon the carpet to count and sort. Normally, he would have wanted to play with the crinkly, shiny wrappers, but none of that mattered to him now. He recounted the night's harrowing events to his mother. When he got to the part about the teenage boys, he felt his mother's body go stiff. After a moment, she solemnly spoke. "Dear Pickles, it is not always safe for us, even on the best of days, but especially not on Halloween. We must stay indoors, for there are cruel people out there who would hurt us simply because we are black cats." "But why?" he implored. The mother did not answer, but said instead, "I do not want you to be afraid. There are good people too." She glanced at the family of human servants who had taken in a wounded stray and her kitten. She continued, "I'm glad you're safe, my little Dill. You are everything to me." Pickle's heart was heavy. He did not want his mother to be disappointed in him. "You're not mad?" he asked. She looked down on him, cuddled him closer, and whispered, "I love you." He looked up and dared to peek, and for the first time, he found the sparkle that had always been there in his mother's eye. Fuck mirrors, by Anonymous. Mirrors have always freaked me out. When I was a kid, I made faces at myself in the mirror above the bathroom sink. I'd seen mimes on TV, one anticipating the other's movements, impersonating their reflection until they fell behind. I stuck my tongue out, raised an eyebrow, grinned wide, and watched my reflection closely for any deviation or hesitation. When I was in seventh grade, my parents attached a full-length mirror to the inside of my bedroom door. It was around this time that I became aware of the fact that reflections are reversed. The horrors of puberty had already begun to make a stranger out of the person in the mirror, but I felt betrayed by this new revelation. It was disturbing to think that, when people looked at me, I didn't really know what they saw. There are so many variables to perception. A tall person sees a different angle than a short one. Light is never consistent. Faces aren't even consistent from day to day due to things like water retention and acne. I became preoccupied with how reflection me perceived real me. What did my reflection see when it looked at me? Was I a reflection to my reflection? When I wasn't looking, did it move on its own accord? When I glanced over, did it sync up with me just in time? If so, did it resent having to keep up the ruse to anticipate my movements? When it reflected my funny expressions back to me, did it secretly wish to reach through the glass and strangle me? At night, I dreaded having to walk past the mirror to get to the bathroom. So, I formed a habit of covering it before sunset. However, one night I fell asleep reading. When I woke up, it was dark out and I'd realized I'd forgotten my nightly ritual. At first, I tried to fall back asleep, but I knew I wouldn't be able to relax until it was covered. I tried not to look at my reflection as I crossed the room, but almost involuntarily, I caught its eyes watching me from the glass. Our eyes, our gazes locked. I was overcome with the feeling that the thing in the mirror somehow wasn't me, that something unknown was watching me, wearing the reversed image of my face like a mask. I quickly covered the mirror and dove back into bed. I felt safe under the covers, with my back pressed up against the wall, and eventually I fell back asleep. Later that night, the sound awoke me. For a moment, I lay frozen in my bed, listening. Then I stuck my head out from under the covers to look around. The mirror lay shattered on the floor. I read once that mirrors are doorways between our world and the spirit world, or something like that. I don't believe in spirits, or in 7 years of bad luck. The hook holding the mirror to the door probably just broke. Still, part of me imagined the reflection of me was trying to escape its glass prison that night. I say trying because, as I cleaned up the broken mirror the next morning, there it was, glaring up at me from shards. Even now, as a fully grown adult, I still cover my mirror at night. Fuck mirrors. If Only, by Priscilla S. Don't take the scarf off, David tells me. He doesn't want me to bring up the subject again. I never knew he was that sensible. But I want to see it already, I tell him. You will, just have some patience, woman. David laughed, so did I. I find it amusing when he calls me a woman. Lately he hasn't wanted to curse. I find it ironic now. I think he's trying to go back to feel on a honeymoon again. I jump as he puts his hands around my neck, sliding slowly, making me feel my skin tingly and prickly. It feels so delightful. He moves in towards the scarf that's covering my eyes, a bit too tight for my liking. I just don't want to make a fuss about it. He takes it off. I see these good-looking, perfectly medium-rare cooked cuts of steaks on the table, with perfectly-looking roasted baby potatoes to accompany a moe and chandon that I took from the cabinet, setting it next to the field of strawberries in the latest set of Lennox platters that you bought for us. He lays his lips on the side of my neck, inhaling, giving me pucker-up kisses as I move my neck, almost gripping his nose, mouth, with a grin and giggle. "Ooh, I can't breathe," he exclaims with a muffled voice. "Sorry, you started it," I tell him. He sits in front of me, looking incredibly good in that suit. The tie makes everything better. Undoubtedly clothes will say a lot about most. I always found suits with a tie somehow exciting. I wonder who they really are when they are not wearing them. My smile slowly fades away as I stare at the rich, savory-looking slices of steak even more. "What is it?" He looks at me while cutting your food. "You know I cannot eat this," I answer under my breath. "If you can, you can. Come on, eat up. I mean, you know you can finish it," David murmured. I looked up with a half grin. "Meaning?" I asked. "Nothing, nothing." David sighs with an annoyed laugh. "You are really leaving tomorrow, aren't you?" I ask, bothered. "You know I do, so stop asking. Just don't. I've had enough of it." He now answered, cutting his food more aggressively, making these awfully painful scratching noises with the new plates. "If you could listen to me, please listen and look at me," with a loud voice I ask. "What?" he shouts as he nails down the steak knife inches close to my hand on the table. "Every single hour that passes by, I plead for you. I plead for you and them to understand that I accept what I did. I'm so sorry for having that attack." I cry with such fright. "Why do you have to be like this?" he asks me with watery eyes. "You took away what I had left," I talk back. "Stop biting your tongue. There was nothing left, and if there was, which would have been your lack of IQ, you would have stayed in your home. More like your grandparents' home, right? I end slumming away for you," he cynically declares. If only looks could kill, I thought. If it wasn't for your fucking revolting desires, I wouldn't have done. Fuck you, you magnet pig. Well, if you would behave like I asked you to, we wouldn't still be here in the first place, would we? So don't blame me for your fucking faults. He points at me with the steak knife. My faults? Just my faults? I laugh. Oh, shut the fuck up. Yes, your faults. You gluttonous, paranoid bitch. If you at least tried like we planned to, I wouldn't. David hesitated, leaving the table, walking to face the big glass penthouse window. You know they're onto us, but I guess you made your choice. You jumped like a jack-in-the-box, remember? David chuckles, looking back at me. Yes, I did, I laugh. He laughed and sat on the couch next to me on the table. I began to sound louder and louder until I buried my face in his shoulder. Forgive me, David, forgive me, I express with a muffled voice. David grabs my face, kisses my forehead, and caresses it. When he removes it, his hand is covered in blood, brain, skull, and flesh pieces. No, Irene, forgive me for everything. I'm a piece of shit. That bullet really got through you good, didn't it? In the brain, just like me, David says to me as he holds me. I put my lips on his left eye. When I remove them, and I can taste the blood on them, just like the steak knife did to you. I guess in the end we have something in common. I laugh, putting one of my hands next to his right cheek, removing a blood tear from it. I guess we do, Irene, he stated to me. David, I ask him. Yes, dear, he asks back. Can you play that classical song that I like, please? From all the classical melodies in the world? Which one? He asks, laughing. The one from Mozart. The one that says Piano Concerto 21 Andante something. I chuckle, covering my face from embarrassment. David starts to laugh even more. Okay, do you remember the whole name of it? I ask him annoyingly. Yes. No. I don't remember, but I know which one you mean, he says as he puts the record on a 70s record player he owns from his mum. It's quite old, so it takes a minute to start. He sits next to me again, laying a side of his head on my shoulder. David, I ask. Yes, dear. He looks up at me. Nothing, I answer him sorrowfully. What is it? He sounds worried. We barely knew each other. It's all my fault, I said as I teared up again. I think I will declare it was both our faults, and I feel terrible every day that you couldn't taste the meal and champagne, he said genuinely. It's all right, it was just food, I laugh. I just really wanted to feel, you know, someone else's touch, I confess to him. I guess in the end we both did, he says to me. I guess we did, I sigh. As the melody starts, David and I jump a little, sitting down as we hear stuff fall from his room, and we see come out of his room a donor, our other tenant, with a bat in her hands, staring at us, as we both have a confused look, then looks to another side, asking if someone was there. For a moment, we thought she actually saw us. I lift my leg, accidentally kicking the living room's coffee table, provoking to drop and break a small glass candy bar, making the donor jump and get out of the apartment, making both Irene and David laugh, feeling bad for her. It never gets old, does it? No, it doesn't. I'm kind of going to miss this, but someday it will be for you. He assures me. If only, David. If only. I say, as I lean back on the couch with an impassive look. Bye-bye. By Shiro-san. It's a weekend. I hang out with my friends. We have a picnic in Maple Forest. The leaves are red as fire in this late autumn. Breeze with earthy smells is so relaxing and comfortable. Everything is perfect until I see her. She's in red dress today, standing behind a tree and staring at me. I'm a little nervous now. I've seen her for several times, but I don't know who she is. Every time I saw her, she's merely staring at me, like what she is doing now. She won't miss any opportunity to approach me. She ruins my perfect picnic. I don't know what she wants from me. The only thing I'm worried about is that she will do the same thing to my friends. That's definitely the last thing I want. This time, I have to ask why. I walk up to her, ask her politely as I can. But to be honest, I have no patience with her. She doesn't reply to me, just smiles in a weird way and makes me uncomfortable. It's the first time she's not staring at me. I should have been for this, but she's looking at my friends now. That'll almost drive me crazy. I shout to her, what do you want? If I did something wrong, just slap me or whatever you want. Stop looking at them. I stand between her and my friends so that she can't see them. Seems she just wants my attention. When I look straight at her, she turns her eyesight to me. That's a relief. Hey, why you stand that far? Is she your girlfriend? My friend asks me, giggling. No, I don't even know. Okay, fine. We're going to an abandoned air raid shelter nearby. Coming or not? You go first. I'll catch up with you in a minute. Okay. We do know. Have a good time with her. They wink to me and leave together. It's not what they're thinking about, but that's good. I don't want her to have anything to do with them, even a simple and meaningless greeting. I'm trying to smile happily as usual. It's hard. Unexpected. I see her following my friends in low speed, straightly, and turn back to glance at me from time to time. That scene blows away all my reason. The only thing on my mind is stopping her. Maybe that's why I pull my knife out and run to her. Then everything is over. I stand between her and my friends, see her fall to the ground in blood. She even had no time to notice that there is no surprise expression on her face, just that gross smile. I cover her body with leaves and clean my knife, my face, and catch up with my friends. It's so good to hear their laughter, to see their happy faces. Finally, I can join them. If I only knew this way can end these things, I would have killed her earlier. When I'm thinking about that, I see the red dress again, hiding behind a maple tree 10 meters away. How can it be? I'm sure I killed her. Guys, I wanna go pee. You go first. Right now? Yes, just go. Okay. Don't be mad, I can enjoy, okay? If this is the only way to end it all, I don't mind to do it again. I walk up to her and see what can never imagine. The wound, so deep. I know I made it. Just on her neck. I can even see the trachea inside. But she can still walk, smile. How could she do that? I don't know, and I don't need to know. I choose to stab her in the stomach this time, and blind her eyes. Much more blood. She falls down again, but it's strange. She has almost no resistance, just staring at me, smiling. That's crazy, like she can't feel any pain. I'm in panic now, leaving her behind and running to my friends. Hey, I'm back. What the fuck? What happened, dude? Why is there so much blood on your clothes and on your face? Well, I have met a wild animal when I went to pee. Wait, you... what? It's nothing. Let's move on. It's so dark in this shelter. Is everything okay? You're strange. I said I'm fine. Just move on and leave, okay? Why are you shouting at me? I'm sorry. I'm frightened. Okay, calm down. Take it easy. It's over. How about having a drink later? That sounds good. Thanks. I'm sorry. I can't tell them what happened. They shouldn't be part of this shit. They should be happy, like before. With the light of the flashlight, we moved carefully into the abandoned shelter. Although there is not many things here, it's not fun to do anything with friends. Don't know why, it feels like there's something. I look back and see a little part of red. I can hardly believe my eyes, but I have to. She stands there, 5 meters away. Hey, guys. Now what, you need to pee again? No, my shoelace is loose. You go first. Do it quickly, we can wait. It's okay, go. How long can it take? We can just go, okay? What's wrong with you? I'm fine, just go. Tell us. I said go. Shit, did I really push my friend to the ground just now? I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. Are you okay? What's wrong with you? We don't understand. Shit, I can see his leg is hurt so bad by steel on the ground. Go to the hospital now, so we're leaving. You happy? Sorry, go fuck yourself. Okay, at least they're leaving now, away from danger now. I can only tell them that to make them feel better. I walk to the girl in the red dress again. If I can protect them, I don't mind, I need to do it again and again. It's all your fault. I push her to the ground. I don't know how many times did I stab, I just want to end this all. I didn't want to be strange to my friends, and I didn't want them in danger, that's all I ask. However, at last I can't even make her stop smiling. I pick up pieces of glass from the ground, insert it into her heart. I hope that works. I have to see my friends now. Sleep tight, please. After apologizing sincerely, they tell me the address. When I get there, I see a girl in a red dress standing in front of my friend's bed. I kill her immediately without hesitation. What are you doing? Shit, it's not her. Did you really kill her? Are you crazy? Get out, you murderer. Okay, take care, please. Fine, at least they are safe for now. When I turn around, I feel like I didn't just get out of the ward, but out of my life. I sit down on the floor, trying to stop my tears, thinking about what I did. I'm tired, exhausted. Now I've lost all my friends. When I look up again, I see that smile, 10 centimeters away from me. Pray, by Brianna Norris. You eye me from across the room, lips pulled into a sly grin. There's no need to call into question the nature of the thoughts swimming beneath those disheveled curls of yours. Our eyes are fixed, a glass presses against my lips, and our egos begin to duel. Chuckling, you immediately admit defeat. and carefully wait to receive dancing bodies to reach me. Checkmate. Insignificant pleasantries are exchanged over bottomless glasses. True intentions left unsaid. You feign curiosity about my past as unbridled desire seeps from your pores. Delicious. With no end to your game in sight, I lean over and whisper the words you so desperately want to say. Want to go back to my place? A fire ignites within your dark eyes, my invitation freeing you from the chains of modesty. We slip out into the night, arms intertwined. Oh, I can't wait for you to be mine. A cab is hailed, an address given. Curious eyes peer into the rearview mirror as your eager hands glide across my thighs. In due time, dear, in due time. Tethered lips barely part to bid thanks as the fare is shoved into the hands of a blushing driver. Stumbling up the stairs and through the door, our passion topples us onto the floor. With each kiss, I can't help but crave more. Flattery pours from your mouth like nectar, but the thrumming of your heart sings me a song that is far better. I graze my mouth along your neck, entranced by its tune. I'm so lucky to have found you. Crimson beads come tumbling down your collar as you shove me away. I watch as you rise. You only have 3 seconds, maybe 5. Your eyes go wide and your body stiffens before crashing to the floor once more. Taking you by the arms, we make our descent. As you murmur atop the coolness of the concrete, I stand within your line of view. My dress falls to the floor. One by one, my legs sprout forth. The confines of my flesh join the discarded garments as I assume my true form. Tears tumble down your cheeks as you bear witness. Trembling, your eyes dart around the room and discover lovers past, their remains strewn. Whimpering, you squeeze your eyes shut as I crawl on top of you, for you know there is no escaping your doom. Round and round you go, wrapped in an ivory cocoon. Your twitching makes me salivate, but as they say, good things come to those who wait. Descending from the silk, my heart begins to swell, and I silently pray that you taste as good as you smell. To Gerald, written by Amber, 4 minutes to midnight, West Germany, 1944, October. The windscreen wipers on the car were going fast, but he couldn't see much. Still 2 kilometers to go, and the clockmaker desperately hoped no air raids would happen. As the storm was so loud, he wouldn't be able to hear the sirens wailing. Suddenly, the car crashed into something, skidded off the wet street and slid across grass and roots, coming to an abrupt halt. The package from the back seat fell through the front screen. He felt his nose bleed and his glasses were broken, but this was nothing compared to the fiasco outside. In the weak beam of the broken headlights, a woman was lying in front of the car. Her head was twisted in a strange way, her body covered with blood and littered with knife wounds. Someone must have tried to stab her. The clothes were unfamiliar, and her empty eyes stared at what had been in the package, an old antique clock that he had just bought on the black market. The one who had sold it to him seemed quite happy to get rid of the clock, and the price was suspiciously low. Ticking, tick, tock, devil's flock, come to me, set me free. He startled. How had the clock hands moved bizarrely counterclockwise to exactly 4 minutes to midnight? A bright flash of lightning struck, followed by ghastly thunder and a petrifying scream. The woman began to move. She smiled and said, "Everything is fine." Her voice was beautiful. She got on her feet, turned slowly away, and vanished into the forest. A faint ticking noise from where she had disappeared into the woods, oddly similar to his antique clock, which was perfectly safe in the package in the rear of the car again. He got behind the wheel and drove into the night. Back home, his wife wanted to know what had happened, but he couldn't talk about it. He desperately needed to repair the clock, for though it ticked happily away, as it stayed stuck always at 4 minutes to midnight. After a few days, there was an article in the newspaper about a woman who had been found injured in the forest with no memory of her life or how she came to be there. A picture showed the lady he'd encountered in that horror of night. After that, he worked frantically on the clock again as the sirens went wailing to warn of an upcoming air attack. An explosion occurred right next to the clockmaker's house. Chaos emerged. His wife rushed into the office, shouting at him in greatest fear. She screamed and begged to leave the house with her and the children waiting outside when the detonations came closer. He grabbed the clock and handed it to his wife. He carried their packed suitcase, unaware of the panic in her eyes, caused not only by the sound of war. She hated the clock since he had brought it home, and she stared at it with agony. Ticking. Tick, tock, devil's flock, come to me, set me free. He was blown off his feet by a gigantic shockwave. The faint sound of a ticking came closer, his eardrums burst, and there was only pain and blood and the ticking, also a horrible scream. He became unconscious. My grandfather hardly survived, but carried the burden of being deaf for the rest of his life. The left side of the house was destroyed, and they never found my grandmother. The only thing left, seen afterwards, was the pendulum of the clock. My grandfather kept it in a cabinet in his office from that day on. The memory of his wife, screaming and shaking, as she seemed to be tortured by the clock she was forced to hold, would never leave him until he died. Nor did the ticking. Germany, 2007, October. Aura was surprised what had been found in the garden by setting up a beautiful fountain well. An antique clock in good condition. Only the pendulum was missing. She thought how pleased her opa would be when he returned from his vacation. She took the clock to his office. This place was fascinating to her since her childhood days. She adored the old oil canvas painting with the beautiful lady in the antiquated dress, sitting at a fountain well in front of a forest, watching herself in a hand mirror. The cabinet was forbidden. She asked herself why and turned away when she saw that the clock hand on the recently found clock moved paradoxically counterclockwise. She felt an uncanny chill and left the room quickly. She went to bed early that night. Ticking, tick, tock, devil's flock, come to me, set me free. She awoke, stuck between reality and dream, and noticed a nightmarish scream to find out whose of her own. She sat in her bed crying, the ticking, tocking, the tick-tocking of her heart, the whole house, everything pulsed in that disturbing rhythm. Like a puppet on an invisible string, she was pulled out of her room, down the hallway, straight towards the clockmaker's office. She had that eerie feeling. She wasn't alone. Her attention got to the clock, summoning her to come close. She was drawn nearer and nearer. The ticking filled her whole being. It felt like deja vu, or as if her worst nightmare. Suddenly, Aura knew what to do. She opened the cabinet, took out the pendulum, and stabbed it deep inside the ticking clock. A horrible scream emerged out of her upstairs, out of the old painting, and united with her own scream. She saw for one second what lay behind the clock's darkness, her own terrified eyes. The clock burst out in blood. It was everywhere, flowing delicately down the old oil painting. Only a fountain well in front of her forest could be seen. Ticking. 4 minutes to midnight. The beast inside, sat alone in bed, stared at Aura's bloody hands, and bitterly cried. Some stories by Eliza Dobbs. The little girl in the bathroom. My sister was around 8 years old when we moved into the house. I was around 4. On many occasions, my mum would find her up and would tell her to go to bed, as it was after midnight. On one particular night, my mum woke to hear her talking to someone, so she got up and she was sitting in the hall by the bathroom. She was rolling a bat and ball. She was rolling a ball, but the odd thing was, it was rolling back to her. Now this surprised my mum, so she asked her who she was talking to. My sister said it was a little girl who was her friend. My mum saw no one besides her and asked her where she went. She said she ran into the bathroom, so my mum went in to see who was there. It was empty. No way in or out unless they went past them. She put her to bed and told her to say her prayers. Apparently, the way we got the house was the family who had it before us had an accident in which their truck was parked on a hill above a river. The parents were inside, but the kids were in the vehicle. It rolled into the river and the kids were killed. One was a little girl around my sister's age. After she said her prayers, she said she never saw her again. The footsteps. Ever since we moved into the house, there were always strange things we kids were blamed for, but none frightened me as much as the odd footsteps we would hear at night. Now, the way the house was laid out, it was a U-shape, Not very big, but the bathroom, kitchen, living room on one side, and all the bedrooms on the other side, one level, so if your bedroom door was open, you could see into the living room. I dreaded waking up at night because my dad would turn off all the lights to save power, so it would mostly be pitch dark. That's when you would hear them, the footsteps. They would start at the bathroom. After the door would creak, then you could hear them pass by the kitchen. Not fast, but heavy, like someone was wearing boots. Then you could hear them pass through the living room, and then they would stop in front of the first bedroom. Then they would start again, and you knew they would be coming your way. Did I dare look? I did once, and saw a large black shape in the faint light that came in the living room window. I told my older sisters what I heard and saw. They had been hearing the same thing. We kept the door closed after that. The imp. When I was around 6 years old, I started seeing this little creature I call the imp. A couple of my sisters had seen something similar, but we didn't like talking about such things because it scared us. They say around Halloween, the veil between this world and the next thins, and it's true. Now, this thing would mostly appear at night, and it would sit in the shadows, in the corner of our room. You sometimes couldn't see it, but you could feel yourself being watched. I'd never look at it for long, because even then I knew that if you see it, it sees you. I don't know why. One night I saw it and decided to stare at it. Big mistake. It was squatting in the corner as usual, but it stood up and didn't appear to be any taller than maybe 3 feet. And all of a sudden it started to form into a black fluid, thick smoke, and started to snake its way up the wall and onto the ceiling. There was moonlight coming into the window, and it seemed careful not to touch it. It went by the window, and at that point I started to panic, so I covered my head with my blanket. The worst part was we slept on bunk beds, and I was on the top bunk, and you could feel the dark intent, and I knew I was in trouble. I said the only prayer I knew at 6 years old, and it was the song, Jesus Loves Me. I felt something sit on the end of my bed, and I passed out at this point singing in my head, because if I made any noise, my dad was just as scary. This happened a few days before Halloween, so it seemed to be freer to roam, I guess. As far as I know, it's still in the house. The kitchen. So I'm the youngest of 5 girls and have 1 younger brother. We were always getting blamed for stuff that we didn't do, such as my parents waking up in the morning and all the pots under the sink would be all laid out on the kitchen floor. My dad would yell at us and we would swear up and down that it wasn't us. So my mum one morning got up a little early. She said she was lying there waiting to hear one of us get up and catch us in the act. But all she heard was the pots hitting the kitchen floor. She jumped up and went into the kitchen in time to see the pots being slid out from the open cupboard and dragged across the kitchen floor. She got scared and woke up my dad, who wasn't happy, but after she told him what had happened, they called the priest in our house to do a blessing on it. It was one of the many I remember being performed at the house. Even after it was done, we would still hear things like someone rummaging in the cutlery, or the cupboard doors being opened and closed, or knocking, or the worst one, someone calling your name, when you know you are the only one in the house. Tree hair ginger ale. Control. Control, this is Command Pilot Calder Burke, Captain of the Alkenast. Come in. Control, comms indicate that I'm transmitting. Can't hear you, but I'll keep talking. We successfully landed on Kepler-22b. Sensors recorded we were there for 2.2 milliseconds before our location changed. And all expedition crew members, co-pilot Vilmaris Santos, mission specialists Afi Onai and Lucas Wagner, science officer Viraj Manu and Dr. Bon Dumont disappeared. Haven't been able to raise anyone on communications. If readings are correct, we are now on an undiscovered planet inside the Orion Nebula, over 1,000 light-years from Kepler. On disembarking the Alkenast, I scouted the terrain. Grey, ancient, dried up river systems. A long night cycle with a sun that never fully rises. No signs of life, but there's a sprawling, angular stone structure, 250 meters tall, at the front of the mountains. Can't miss the damn thing. If the crew is planet side, they'll look here. I'll find them and commence exploration before returning to the ship. Hope by then the nav can figure out what happened, get us back on track. Entering structure. Brightly lit, white lights, no ceiling. Clear stars above, no astronomical scintillation, so no atmosphere? Hate that. I know systems engineer men would love this, but without atmospheres, the vacuum of space is too damn dark. Stars ought to twinkle, not stare apathetically. Despite the view, sensors indicate a perfectly breathable air mixture. Walls are a brushed metallic texture. There's a sheen, perhaps a force field. Polished, marble-like floor, white and grey. Uninterrupted by seams or markings of any kind. There should be echoes on my footsteps in an empty room this huge, but it's absolutely silent. Rectangular doorway, 20 meters away, leading further into the building. Control. I've been on enough missions to know when someone's following. Sensors aren't picking it up, but I feel it. Another doorway. There's only ever one new doorway leading westward. Should be traveling along a continuous east-west line yet. I sometimes get the feeling that I'm doubling back, circling. While backtracking eastward leads me to another room, not back the way I came. It's a labyrinth. Trying to figure out how it works. And aggregations here on the floor. Pristine, preserved organs. Not human. Symbols meticulously scrawled next to them in purple liquid, as if dissection notes. Scanning the fluid. This is written in its blood. I'm officially abandoning exploration objectives. Priority is finding the crew and returning them to the ship. If that means my resignation, fine. There's a tapping sound. Glass-like. No. No discernible source. The further I go, the more remains I'm finding. Each room is like an autopsy bay. So many different alien species methodically displayed on the floor. Sentient, if equipment and clothing is any tell. Some of them, God, the claws on this one. Wouldn't have wanted to meet that alive. Control, I've been in skirmishes before, seen the damage that advanced weaponry can do, seen a lot of AI surgeons' handiwork too, but these cuts are impossibly clean. I don't even know if you'd feel these kind of incisions. Control, whoever's been following me has made an appearance. It's not humanoid. Don't recognize any eyes among the shapes, but I feel I am watched. It consistently mimics my pace. Let's try first contact. I am Command Pilot Calder Burke of Planet Earth, leading the exploratory crew of the Alkanost. We are here in peace. Can you understand me? No response. The translator malfunction, or its language doesn't adhere to discernible linguistic patterns. Or it's just not up for chatting. It's a silver glimmer, vertically arranged, intermittently reflecting a pink and gold glow, shifting and connected surfaces sliding horizontally in midair. Gotta be the source of that tinkling, empty glass-like tapping. Its sound phases in and out of hearing, same way it's phases in and out of sight. You know my twin? How did I forget I have a twin? Imogen, Maya Kid's sister, told me that meeting a multidimensional creature would be like a 2D character on a piece of paper observing a 3D apple. The 2D being cannot see all the 3D apple at once, like an MRI. You only see cross-sections wherever the apple comes into contact with the surface of the paper, in contact with our dimension. Still no response. Increasingly hard to focus, mind circling. If that continues, I won't be able to find my own way out. I'm assuming I'll eventually have to fight, then wait for the others to find me. More remains. Jesus, the size of this skull. I can't guess how this one lost. Organs similarly sized. Tidy notes in clear bee blood. In clear green blood. Control. I'm no longer sure of my chances in a fight. At least I came here alone. I want to remind Essie Mahenan that Myella is a fussy girl. She doesn't eat that new insta-meat cat food. Promise me you'll feed her the good stuff. Or there's danger the beauty will starve herself. Dr. Dumont, you know I'm healthier than a horse. I could probably run to Kepler and get back before the Alkanos does. Yeah, go ahead, scan me. Physically, mentally, whatever, I know I'm up for this. Doctor? Fuck, you're not here. Control, I hallucinated. I think it scanned me. The star field above me has been marked with a holographic, like a dot on a map. That's the location of the Milky Way.
of Earth. Control. I think that after they study beings that come here, they go after the rest. I repeat, shit. Feet are slippery. What am I still... Blood. Red blood. It's coming from me. There's a hole. Holes in my torso. Oh. God. What are you? Who are you? No, don't. There are no more words in the verified transcript received from communications. There was screaming and repeated discharge of a phaser, followed by Burke's indecipherable gurgling and sounds that can only be described as cutting, both continuing for 25 minutes before transmission abruptly ends. The Harvest by Andrea. First, they took our screams, and for a while, we didn't notice. It might be more accurate to say that we didn't care. We went about our business with a vague sense that something was missing. We went on with our lives with the sense that we had lost something simultaneously superfluous and essential. We only began to notice the lack of even a yelp when Halloween came around and the stories that we had relied on to connect us with this primal. And the stories we had relied on to connect us with the primal failed to produce any pleasure through the threat of pain. By then, they'd already taken our sense of uncanny as well. Everything felt familiar and safe. Nothing felt strange or out of place or even novel. And with the absence of the uncanny, we lost our goosebumps. The hairs on the back of our necks rested in place. Our spines felt no chills, and our pulses climbed only when we engaged in aerobic exercise. But still, we failed to recognize what had been taken from us. A brief period of mourning for what we had lost was quickly replaced by an optimism about what we had been liberated from. Perhaps we convinced ourselves to be fearless was the next step in our evolution. Indeed, for a long time, we thought that we had lost fear itself. In truth, it had not been taken from us. Yet. We had just become very, very good at ignoring fear and only bringing it to the surface when it served our purposes. We still had the capacity to be afraid when they took away our pain. We'd evolved to the point where our intellect set us apart from other animals, and yet we failed to recognize the value of our animal pain. It is easy to forget that pain is our body's way of telling us something is wrong. The euphoria of drugs, or even the runner's high, only lasts so long before the body seeks to repair itself. And before they came, we let it because of pain. What they began to take from our bodies seemed of little consequence. Nothing to raise any alarm at first. A little bit of blood when a wound was fresh. A little bit of pus later on once the wound began to fester. Of course, we tended to our wounds diligently at first and, out of habit, with bandages and antibiotics. The doctor's visit if something looked like it might fall off. But gradually, we took our newfound freedom for granted and got lazy. Fevers were overlooked because we were getting so much done. Their collections were tolerated because they kept us cleaner than we would have otherwise been. And at some point, amidst all our productivity, we were the ones who took our fear and discarded it, as if it were an old pair of pants that no longer fit. They did not even need to take it from us. When it came time for the harvest, there were no screams, no fear, nothing left to protect. Joluda, Kelidwen. Children often fall between the cracks of society. In my case, it wasn't some human tragedy that caused my fall, but one from another world entirely. Like many children of poor families, I was left to wander. My playgrounds were gutters and copses of trees between crumbling concrete. On one of these trips, I found my best friend sitting in a circle of stones, as if waiting. He was a white cat, with a grey spot on his chest and knowing yellow eyes. From then on, Ghost followed me. Not terribly imaginative of a name, but I was a kid. He didn't seem to mind. Ghost followed me home. My parents were arguing and didn't notice him sneaking inside. However, before I could climb the steps to my room, the phone rang. I hadn't heard it ring in a long time, but I was normally outside.
My parents weren't coming to answer it, so I shuffled over and picked up the receiver. Hello, I whispered. What shall we see? It's been a lifetime, a calm feminine voice explained. Glan? I asked. A memory floated on the edge of my mind, but I couldn't recall her face. Yes, yes, tell me how you are, my child, she asked. This began the routine of Gran's calls. I worried about Mother finding out. She didn't like me inside, but Gran never called when my parents were around, except the last time. Father had lost his job and was home. He'd wake up, drink a cup of coffee, then settle in front of the telly with a beer. By the end of the day, there'd be glass bottles and cans littering the floor. Eventually, Mother snapped and the normal fighting turned deadly. I was talking to Gran when it happened. Mother found me on the phone. Stop playing and go to your room. What is wrong with you, I swear, she screamed. Shushy, put down the phone and go to your room with Ghost, Gran told me calmly. Okay, bye. Oh, for Christ's sake, go to bed, Mum yelled. Dad stumbled into the room and smacked her. Do you ever fucking shut up, he raged. I did not stay to see more. Maybe I was a bad child for not calling the police. Maybe I should have ran to the neighbours instead of my room, but I did what Gran said. Ghost waited on the stairs, and I followed him. The screaming didn't stop. I put my head under my pillow and waited. I fell asleep and woke up suddenly to the smell of smoke. My door burst open and Father stood there, covered in blood, smoke billowing from behind. In fear, I froze, managing a whimper, but before smoke made tears close my eyes and throat. You, he screamed. You little monster. Life was fine until your brother died. And we were left with you. I knew about my dead twin, but I didn't understand why he hated me. All I could process was fear. I could not move as I cried. Father took heavy, booted steps towards me. I crawled close to my window and fumbled to find the latch. The crushing grip of my father grabbed my hand. I felt cracking. The pain blasted up my arm. I gasped, inhaling more smoke. He lifted me like a dead rat and threw me. I tensed, expecting to hit hardwood. Instead, I was stopped by furry white arms that set me gently down. Then there was running, glass shattering, and wind blasted inside, as if it were alive and angry. Through my tears, I saw the white creature crouching. It opened a wide, toothy mouth. I covered my ears and curled up against the wall as it roared. I couldn't block out my father's screams, the approaching fire, or my pounding heart. Crunching, squelching, growling, and finally a wet thud came from where they had been. I could feel the fire hotter on the wall, and the wind was gone. I thought I was going to be eaten or burned alive. I wish Father had killed me first. The floorboards rumbled under me as something came near. I curled into a tighter ball. Soft, velvet arms picked me up. I opened my eyes, meeting large yellow ones before passing out. When I woke, I was in a large bed under a quilt. The door to the bedroom was open, and I could hear movement. From the doorway, Ghost's yellow eyes appeared. He hopped onto the bed and nudged me, purring. I scooped him up into my arms and got up. I wore a long white nightgown down to my bare, blistered feet. It hurt for a moment, but I was able to walk. I followed the sounds to an aromatic kitchen. I entered, and a tall woman with golden hair sang at the stove. She stirred a large pot, and while following instructions from a book, Ghost hopped from my arms and stood on his hind legs. He walked to her and pointed one paw at me. I was again frozen, but with surprise. Oh, what shall I see? The woman turned. She was perfectly beautiful, with green eyes and flawless skin. Her simple dress and apron couldn't hide the ethereal air around her. Gran, I stammered, like the first call. She smiled with bright, sharp teeth. Yes, though you can call me Gran Kerry. I've missed you so. She picked up a wooden mug and ladled in glowing liquid from the pot. With care, she offered the mug to me. Here, drink this and you'll be safe. I looked down at my burned feet. I thought about the blood splattered around yellow eyes and the pain of my father's grasp. Ghost, now as tall as me, put a paw on my arm and nodded. I took the mug and drank. Sometimes children fall into cracks and disappear without a trace. But sometimes that fall leads us home. Fae, the Ouija board, the orphanage, and the demon. She had whispered in my ear. I swear, We'll do it this time. We talked about the idea of me going months before. It seemed so easy to say yes to an abstract idea. I had agreed believing I would never really need to go. The energy is stronger at the orphanage than anywhere else. He'll be able to come through there and bring them with him. Had I realized how long the trip on the train would take, I would have definitely had second thoughts, but this was a last-ditch attempt. I shivered, despite the heat. Could I really go through with it? The sun streamed into the carriage, glinting off the glass and making it far too hot for me to lean against. I sat up straight, aware of her leg touching mine. I could feel her eyes boring into me, so I peered out of the window. We were finally getting close enough for me to discern the town. She'd said it was small. If I squinted, I could just make out the rough, grey-brown shapes of the houses huddled together between the trees. Every lawn was overgrown, and long green tendrils snaked up the sides of at least half the buildings. Although the day was bright, the trees cast the whole scene in shadows, and it reminded me of something. Suddenly I realized what? A graveyard. I shook my head and laughed out loud, dismissing this ridiculous idea. She started at my laugh. I glanced at her with a reassuring smile, but she was staring intently at me again. I squirmed at her scrutiny. We're almost there now. I turned and gave her a quick nod, then resumed my search, gazing out of the window again. As I idly watched the scene in front of me slowly come into focus, I thought about the circumstances that led to my friendship with this girl. She just appeared one day. I was in the office, getting a late slip, when one of the nuns walked up to me with this thin, pale, dark-haired figure and instructed me to show her around the school, then take her to class with me. Afterwards, she'd followed me around like a puppy for a week. I was alone too. My only friend Melissa had died the previous year from a stroke at 15. It had been as shocking as it was sudden. Truthfully, I had been grateful for the company. We were both lonely and sad. Slowly, over time, she opened up to me. She had no parents. She lived in an orphanage. She was into the occult. One day, out of the blue, she told me she had a Ouija board. She brought it to school, showing me one of the loo cubicles. I'd only half believe she was telling the truth. I think that was the moment I became obsessed with the idea of using the board. We spent the next few months sneaking around, using it every chance we got. If I was really honest with myself, it was the main reason we were friends. I needed her to get to them. It wasn't just my best friend. There was someone else who had lost as a young child. Someone who, to that point, had refused to come through, despite my best efforts. My grandmother. After 3 months, I was becoming frustrated. We'd made some headway with the other side, contacting several spirits who insisted they were good, but could not help us reach her. We were close enough now for me to see the plant-covered houses I'd mistaken for a graveyard. I smiled again at the silly thought, then I did a double take. As the train rattled by, I realized they weren't houses at all. They're mausoleums, came her voice in my ear, startling me. No gravestones or markers, just mausoleums. For 120 years, there was nothing else here, just the orphanage and this. She gestured with her hand, her eyes shining. The town's original name meant new beginnings, but after a while, everyone just called it death. Everyone around here was owned by three families. Everything around here was owned by three families, dating back to 1831. Can you imagine how many bodies are in there? I shuddered at the thought. 10 minutes later, we arrived at the tiny station. Dirty and dilapidated, it looked as old as the mausoleums. We followed the platform till it sloped away to nothing, then crossed the train tracks. I could see the orphanage clearly now, growing larger with every passing second. After a short walk, I stood in the entrance, staring up at the huge wooden double doors. The hush of the interior seeped out, enveloping me. I hesitated, deeply unsettled by the butterflies in my stomach and the rushing of my blood in my ears. She grabbed my hand, dragging me through the warren of passageways to her room. The marble saints stared down imperiously from their niches carved into the walls. I winced at every footfall that echoed off the stone floor and seemed to crescendo around us. At last we reached her room. The hinges creaked as she threw open the door. I sighed in relief. Sunlight streamed through a huge window, and rugs muffled our footsteps on the floor. She dropped my hand immediately, striding the last few steps to her bed. Thrusting her arms between the metal frame and the mattress, she withdrew the Ouija board. Immediately she sat down, cross-legged, placing it on the floor, and looked up expectantly at me. I
closed the door behind me, then joined her. I pushed aside my feelings of unease. This was it. This time, we would succeed. I tried to concentrate, my field of vision narrowing to a tiny square, and then nothing but the board existed. I heard rustling and scratching as she hurriedly grabbed pencil and paper, and then the scrape of the wood planchette as she set it on the heavy board. As we placed our fingers on it, our eyes locked, and for a second, I saw something flare behind them. I frowned, but tried to convince myself it was my imagination, or maybe it was just this place. Come on, concentrate. Her voice was a low, droning sound, like the buzzing of a fly, as she spoke to our spirit friends, explaining everything was ready. I closed my eyes, concentrating hard on Melissa and my grandmother, praying, pleading, begging for them to come through. At that exact moment, like a switch had been flipped, the light in the room dimmed. Clouds passing over the sun and blocking the light, making the room suddenly darker and impossibly more eerie. In the complete stillness, I was acutely aware of the sudden rise in the volume of her speech. Come, come through now. Everything is prepared. My eyes snapped open. She froze me on the spot with her gaze and I saw the flare again. Your vessel is ready. Come now and take this body, she continued. My eyes darted away from her face. I glanced around in confusion, unable to comprehend what I was seeing. A knife, the board covered with blood, her insane smile that sent chills down my spine. I felt a small niggle in the back of my brain that tried to make sense of it all. I grabbed and pulled as hard as I could at the thought, when at last I had it. It was the light. It hadn't come back. Even though the clouds had passed, where was the sun? No, it's not possible, my brain stalled. The blackness was deepening, seeping from the corners of my eyes and bleeding inch by inch over the Ouija board, filling my vision. As I watched, transfixed in horror, a gnarled hand formed in the gloom. Charred and covered with blood, the scaly hand had festering wounds that oozed pus and matted its fur. With its long, dirty nails, it reached out for me. There was more of her cackling laughter. Then I heard a blood-curdling scream.
Oldest and Strongest Kind of Fear by Ginger D. Caught on a moor near twilight, fear had not walked with Mary those first few hours as she sought adequate shelter. Indeed, it had been far from her as she levelled herself down the untread path. She married herself with the quiet of nature, content in her solitude, and was only worried for the wind messing her hair. But, as the shadows grew longer, and the sky took on the bloodied hours of final light, Mary became suddenly seized with terror of a menacing nature. The wind picked up abruptly, and Mary was swallowed by a howling gale that ripped through the moors and towards the mountains. As she faced away from the wind to get her bearings, a shadow passed far ahead of her underneath the quickly fading light. Her gaze could not land on the thing itself, so unnatural was its shape in God's lands that her mortal mind could not grasp its features, and she was struck by terror to flee. In the moor where she once gloried of nature untamed, Mary fought against the earth that had shifted radically from familiar, silent companion to sinister and hostile stranger. The wind bashed against her like a thousand hands, every step now part of a dance to remain upright as Mary stumbled over decayed grass and jagged stones. She could hear the approach of the creature behind her, its presence like thunder in the air. As it gained ground and the sound of its gait was as the cracking of a great many carcasses of bugs being crushed in the palm of her hand. Her ears felt raw to bleeding just to hear of its approach. As she choked on her beating heart and burning lungs, Mary marked her salvation in the distance, her body, lichen-covered, nearly missed in the looming darkness but deliverance. Respirited, Mary pushed her muscles to tearing in the haste for her safety. The ground trembled underfoot as the creature pursued, but Mary refused to turn and witness its grotesque, unseeable matter. Nearer the body drew, and louder the creature chased at her heels. She could not slow. The beast's cacophonous cackling grated the air just at her back as Mary crashed into the body's rear wall. She rolled narrowly out of the beast's trajectory as it followed and rammed into the worn sandstone. Its form splattered in the dark and separated like ink in water. Mary screeched as the spray hit her arm on rounding the corner. There was no side entrance. Her ankle twisted on the second corner. Thank God, the door. As she dragged herself by the uneven stones of the bodies on the wall, Mary grasped the rusted latch of the door and pulled herself to the wooden rot of the frame. She heaved the latch and cried as the worn iron cut into her hands. The latch jerked incrementally. Her whole body shook as she pulled. Another scant give from the latch. Her lips trembled on a silent scream as she used her last burst of strength to pull harder. The latch finally opened with a groan. Mary scrambled inside, turned, and bolted the door behind her. Mary panted in agony as she gazed at the bloody nail marks she left on the inside of the body's wooden door. Her blood oozed onto the floor at the door's sill. The thing beyond the door was quiet. She heard only her breathing, her jackrabbit pulse in her ears. Mary realized slowly that her hands were still clenched so tightly that her bones were almost likely to break open her own skin. Numbly, she uncurled her fingers and then creaked as though warming from rigor mortis. It was difficult to see in the windowless space of the body, but it looked almost as if the blood was moving. In the time between breath and scream, the atramental fragments of the monster's body burrowed their way into Mary's blood via the wounds on her hands. Mary tossed her body back and forth onto the dirt of the body floor. Screams and cries trapped in her throat as the foreign bodies squirmed under her skin. The great agony of their intrusion caused her body to seize and thrash with every undulation of their travel up her arms. When it passed from the fat and tissue of her biceps to her clavicle, Mary nearly succumbed to unconsciousness as she felt it scrape the bone. It wriggled up into the muscles of her throat, locked her open jaw into place. Mary choked and gurgled as her throat fought the restrictive hold of the intruders. She could hear the distant sound of snapping exoskeletons inside her head. Mary's tears fell as it closed in on her eyes. Darkness etched her vision. It closed in slowly, with a malicious glee at her anguish. Fear grabbed Mary's heart, dug its claws in. Her eyesight darkened entirely. Her body shook with inaudible screams. Time passed. Mary didn't know how much, only that her world was focused to the singular point of her lost vision, her diminished voice. Suddenly, after time indeterminate in that paralysis, light and sound burst through the miasma of misery. It was sunrise. Birds sang. Her body ached from the stranglehold the beast had on her, but she forced her hands to move to her face and strike her own eyes. They felt like her own. She panted and gasped for air as she heaved herself at the door, forced the ancient latch to unlock and dragged it open, and froze. There was no beast, but its terror scarred the body's grasp deeply. Tracks the size of craters and with the characteristics of a dozen animals had the earth to tatters. The stone body wall was nearly carved out from horrific claw marks the size of a healthy man. What had it wanted? Where did it go? Mary cried, distressed, exhausted, and her tears fell into the dirt. They were black.
Embers by Marlin. There it is again. The faint scent of sour smoke. After a week-long assault on those in mind, making me think I'm losing mine, I find myself heading to the door, fetching a coat, putting on shoes. There's a chill in the air, red leaves on the trees, holding on for as long as nature permits before gently tumbling down towards the cold and uncaring ground to die, to rot. My feet seem to know where they are heading, but I do not. I just feel there's something this way. My nose seems to agree, so I keep going, yet the few people I meet in the dusk-lit street seem unperturbed, unaware. I keep walking. Eventually, something tugs at my consciousness, trying to shift my attention to the left, so left I turn. Down one of the main roads, where loads of people are still milling about on their early night business. The shops are closing for the day, and my feet take me farther and farther down the road towards the old hospital. The last light of today's bright sun fades, and the night is darker and the air heavier than can be accounted for by an autumn eve. I shudder. My feet stop. The hospital towers over my hatless head, partially backlit by eye-tiring sodium lights. Out of the corner of my eye, a flash like that of a frayed power cable still plugged in. I turn to look, and my eyes find the outline of a person crouching by something in a corner. I cannot make it out. Flash. I shut my eyes against the bright white light, nose filled with the smell of acrid smoke. What the hell? The next flash is muted by my eyelids, but still bright as a small sun. Carefully, I open first one eye, then the other, and struggle to come to terms with what they see. In the time it takes for me to blink, the whole hospital is gone. In its place, a charred black skeleton of a building, much like it stands. Flash. My hand is not quite quick enough to block it out. The hospital is right there, orange glow behind it. I blink again. The silhouetted person is too far away for me to see what precise movements it makes, but it seems to me as though it is staring straight at me as it strikes a match. Flash. The last thing I see before the intensity forces me to give into darkness is two burning eyes locked onto mine from out the center of that strange silhouette. Another flash, cracked and sundered, as if ravaged by hungry eons, the skeletal structure stands. I stand and blink. A million questions fill my head, and yet the loudest one, the one that wins over all the others, is, why did I come here? Why did I come here without a hat and without locking my door? And why is the cold gone? The cold is gone. In fact, there's warmth, and it's coming closer from behind me. Accompanying it is that sickening, mind-numbingly strong smell of something sour, not quite burning yet. I do not have time to turn around. The approaching warmth, the tingling in my neck, the sound of slow inhalation, and the inevitability of what cannot possibly even be true give me a short eternity to reflect upon the hot breath and the massive teeth that dig into me before I too join the charred, blackened, skeletal remains of this dragon's dinner. The Festering of an Innate Darkness by a late submitter. Before the beginning, there was nothing. In the void grew an abyss, a cesspool of primordial muck that churned and bubbled forth, regurgitating itself to the point of creation. From that pit, a shadow emerged, darkness personified. This non-being formed of nothing wandered the vast emptiness for a time before time and eventually saw the birth of worlds and of man. With everything created, he found himself drawn to symbiotically insert himself. A way to destroy, not of. A way to destroy not of inflicted malice, but of time's natural decay, collapsing stars in on themselves and mutating the flesh of living beings to cancerous rot until all returned home to oblivion. Just as a bud blooms to a rose and eventually wilts to nothing more than an oozing pool of putrid decay, so too does a soul, once bright and full of innocent vigor, eventually warp and wither from the pain of living until it's eventually stricken numb and snuffed out entirely. Katie is cocooned in a mass of Sherpa. She unconsciously pulls the covers to her chin, sighing relief that she is warm and safe, snuggled in her bed. Her slight body rhythmically rises and falls with each breath in a melodic overture to the stillness of night. Moonlight seeps in from the adjacent window, illuminating a halo of wispy blonde strands that gently billow in sync. She sleeps so soundly that she has no regard for the dark figure towering over her. I stand, wide-eyed and unmoving, mouth hanging agape in horror. Katie, I try to yell, run, Katie! But no words or even sounds are uttered. Yet, in my petrified state, he knows I am watching him as he moves closer towards my daughter. The figure bends down for further inspection. He considers her for a moment, and then turns to me. I can't see a face, just a dark blur where one should be. But his words, however ragged and whispered, are as clear as day. I wonder if her insides are as pretty as she is. His shadowy hand brushes a stationary lock of hair from her tiny doll-like face. He raises the other, holding a hunting knife glistening silver with smears of liquid sanguine along its serrated edge. Get the fuck away from her. I try to will my body to lurch towards him to no avail. She looks like a mummy, doesn't she? He turns towards me and traces the knife through the air in an hourglass figure, pulls back and thrusts it forward. Mummy had it coming though, didn't she? He almost sounds amused. As pretty as she was, slitting her open from belly to sternum proved her insides to be rather ordinary. There was nothing any more unusual about her entrails than that of a slaughtered pig. Katie suddenly stirs. She yawns and rubs the sleep from her eyes. Slightly disoriented and feeling someone watching her, she slowly raises up. She blinks several times, her eyes adjusting to the darkness, when she sees him standing over her. Daddy? She asks, smiling up at me. What's that you're holding?